Welcome to the workshop on patients and public involvement and engagement in health and social care, its role and relevance in research and implementation process. So ladies and gentlemen, this is the second consecutive year that a workshop is conducted by the Institute for Research and Development in collaboration with the Sri Lanka Medical Association as one of its pre-Congress workshop of the annual International Medical Congress. The patient and public involvement and engagement is the means of keeping the patient perspective at the heart of our research and learning from their experiences of living with the topic under study or the research. Public involvement in research is defined as research being carried out with or by members of the public rather than to, about, or for them. As we all know, research topics are often decided by the researchers. Therefore, it is important if we can gather the views of patients, carers, family members, and the health and social care professionals, which will pave the way to ensure that the research are aligned with what matters to those directly affected. The PPIE has a unique advantage. We believe that no matter how complicated the research is or how brilliant the researcher is, the patients and public always offer unique, invaluable insights to the topic of the study or research. Their advice when designing, implementing, and evaluating research invariably make the studies research more effective, more credible, and often cost effective as well. So we have quite a few eminent speakers for today's workshop. We have Professor Dianath Samarasinghe, former Professor of Psychiatry, Faculty of Medicine, University of Colombo; Dr. Duminda Guruge, the Head Department of Health Promotion, Rajarata University; Dr. Buddhika Fernandu, Honorable Research Associate at Institute for Research and Development, the lead bioethics initiative, and currently she is in UK and she is coming for this particular workshop; and Dr. Asiri Hema Malage, consultant community physician, who will be shortly with us; and Dr. Kaushalya Jayaveera, lead biomedical research at the Institute for Research and Development; Ms. Manori Vimalasekara, our PPIE coordinator at the Institute for Research and Development; Ms. Krishani Jayasinghe, research assistant at the Institute for Research and Development. In addition, we have a few members from our own community, Ms. S.A. Samarakon, Ms. H.P. Samantika Jeevani, Ms. Airangani Vijayaratna, and Sadamali Lianage to contribute to this workshop. So we, on behalf of the Institute for Research and Development and the SLMA, we welcome all of you to this workshop, and without any due for the, we should continue our workshop, and I hope that you will have fruitful discussions today and make sure that you will take home quite interesting memories of this workshop, and you will continue to do research with the correct understanding of PPIE, its concept, and how it can be incorporated in your research work when you go back to the field for doing research. So thank you very much, and once again I wish that from the IRD, I'm Nihal Abhesinghe, the deputy director of IRD, so welcome, and wish that you will have a fruitful discussions today, and I am sure that you will be enriched on the subject of PPIE during this workshop. Thank you very much. And next, I'll call upon Buddhika to take over from here, and we will go by the agenda, and I'm sure some of you may not have received the copy of agenda, but we will, without making much time taking from you, and we will continue with our program. Thank you very much.
Probably, can you hear me? Do you still need the mic? Can you hear me clearly? Then I'm going to let go of this. But if you can't hear me at any point, tell me, then I will pick it up. All right? So, my name is Budhika. I'm going to be talking to you about the international standards in PPIE. What is PPIE? And then, after that, our colleagues will speak to you and give you details about how we have adapted these international standards to our conditions. As Dr. Abhisinghe mentioned previously, we have expertise in our own country. We have carried the international standards even further forward in PPIE by getting people to actually participate in research and to carry out implementation research as well. And you will be hearing more about that later. And I shall start with what is the international standards in PPIE, what is expected, and then we will go on from there. So, yeah, that is very useful. Help, it's not moving. There, that's better. Yeah. Thank you. Sorry about that. Yeah. Right. Now, I can see the majority of you are ladies here. So you have been, I'm sure all of you have been cooking, and the gentleman will at least have made a cup of tea. So that is what PPIE is all about. You are all researchers, right? But when you're making a cup of tea, if you don't put in the sugar to the right extent, or the milk to the right extent, or the tea leaves to the right extent, your tea is not going to be right. Similarly, you are researchers with research experience. You may be researchers with clinical experience as well. If you try to do research with only research experience, generally that is not a very useful or fruitful way of doing research, because you don't know how it applies to your patients. So you need clinical experience as well. However, if you do not put in the salt correctly into your dish or the sugar correctly into your dish, your tea is not tasty, your whatever it is that you are cooking will not be tasty, or it will not be of the best quality. The same way, if you don't involve your patients and ask them to speak to you about their life experiences and their actual experience of the condition that you are planning to research into, you are missing a vital ingredient in your research. And that is why it is important to involve patients and public in your research. Now, when we say PPIE, we talk of two groups of people. One is patients, the other one is the public. The patients, it seems obvious. You know best whether it has been, if it is your disease, you know best where it hurts, how much it hurts, when it hurts, and you are best placed to advise the researcher on what questions to ask to research your condition most correctly. Isn't that the case? You go and tell your doctor, this is my problem. Similarly, you should tell your researcher that these are my problems, and that is why the patient is best placed to advise the researchers on how the research can be conducted. Why the public then? Why do you think the public should be involved? Public doesn't necessarily have an experience of the particular disease. But the public involves, who do you think the public involves? Other than the patients themselves, who would it involve? Why the public? Anyone cares to comment?
Families.
Families, right? So it involves the families of the particular patients or the condition that you are going to research. Or it may involve, let's say we are researching about autistic children. Then it would involve the teachers who have had exposure to that kind of children. Or if you are looking at let's say domestic abuse, okay? If you are looking at domestic abuse, the partners, the parents of those people, all of them will have opinions. And also, it is not just that people who have had a living experience of that, but also people who are able to give us a different perspective. Now, we as clinicians or medical people or scientific people may not necessarily see how an economist would look at it, or a social scientist would look at it, or an educationist would look at a question. So they can all add value to it, which is why the ingredients, when all added to research experience, clinical experience, and the life experience of people, we can make our research question better, our entire research more fruitful and more valuable. Then, so as Dr. Abhisinghe told previously, research carried out with and or by members of the public or patients, rather than to, about, or for the public and patients. It is merely a different way of looking at things, right? And why do we do it? Because we can benefit from the insights, experiences of the public and patients to help develop a more complete or holistic outlook of the question we are trying to research. But it starts entirely from the mindset. Because we have to start with the mindset that you can't plan and deliver high quality research if you do not know the end user's perspective. What is the point of research? The point of research is to develop treatments or management methodologies that will ultimately benefit your patient. If you don't know what your patient wants most, how can you end up doing a fruitful research or a more useful research? That is why it is important to start with the mindset that in order to do the best quality research and to do something that is most useful for patients, we have to start off by asking the experiences of the end users of the research themselves. If we don't do that, if we assume that we know best, we are the researchers, then we start off with a mindset that says, you, the patient, are not important. I know best, and I will tell you what you want rather than you, the patient, tells me what you want. That is why it is important to get this right at the beginning. And my slides are not behaving very well. So we are going to look at who, when, where, how, why, and what of PPIE. And let's start off by this is the answer that was given by the Chief Medical Officer of England as to why we carry out PPI. She said that no matter how complicated the research or how brilliant the researcher, patients and the public always offer a unique and invaluable insight into designing, implementing, and evaluating research. Because that can make your study more effective. You can know what your patient wants more. It can make it more credible, and it can make it much more cost effective. Then we go on to the next aspect of it. Why is it morally necessary? Now, we always talk about the ethical aspects of research. There is a moral argument that says that PPIE in research is essential. Now, I know some of you here have come to our previous workshops and some of you are new. So those who have heard these arguments before, the basic things about PPIE previously, will have to bear with me a little bit so that the others who haven't heard of this before will have to get I'll have to repeat that necessarily. Yep. So the moral argument is that our research is publicly funded. The public pays for it, right? Government taxes or whatever, the hospital fees, all of that will pay for our research. So if the public is paying for it, shouldn't the public benefit most from it? So because the public is paying for this research, it is necessary that the research should be shaped and informed by the people who it will affect the most. The second argument is that over the last 20 years since PPIE has been started to be incorporated into the research landscape, it has been repeatedly shown that including PPIE has made research better by including the life experience of people, of the people, the public, the patients, those who are suffering from the condition. Thirdly, there's increasing evidence that the benefits of PPIE in research has been adding up. But even if you don't agree with any of that, now you can't avoid including PPIE in research, because if you want funding from any Western funding organization, you have to include PPIE in your research. Why? Because they accept that the involvement of patients to shape that research is a critical aspect of the research. So be it the West, the USA, the any European funding station, Australia, Singapore, anywhere, if you want to get funds from them, if you want to publish in a journal, in a high impact journal, they will ask you, have you included patients and the public in your research, and how have you done that? And if not, you will have to give reasons, and you will not get the money. It's as simple as that. So that is that. If that is not a compelling argument for PPIE, I don't know what is. But that is not the main reason. You should not do it for the money, but I'm telling you that you can't get the money anyway. And there you go. So where did this PPIE business come from? Now, earlier you have heard of the term medical paternalism, right? The doctor knew best, and the doctor told the patient, this is how you should behave, this is how you should treat, this is what your treatment should be. The doctor knows best. From there on, we moved a little more into patient autonomy, right? Now patient autonomy is a little more accepted, even in our parts of the world. We accept that patients should have more say in their treatment, and they should know more about what their treatment is, how they are going to be managed, their families or themselves. Patient autonomy is now much more accepted in our parts of the world. It is mandatory in the West. And it is simply a next step forward to say that if patients are autonomous beings, patients are people who should know about their treatment, then if a patient or a participant in research is being involved in the research, they should also be not merely have things done to them, but they should also be involved and engaged and be part of the research process, not merely have things done to them. And so that is what it has evolved into. Right at the bottom you see participation. So participation is merely, you treat them as subjects of a study. We don't even use the word subjects anymore. Why? Because that puts them into some level below the researcher, right? A subject is always something, you have something done to if I am a subject, I have something done to me, with or without my concurrence or agreement. So therefore, we don't even use that term anymore. Patients and the public are not, they are not test animals, they are not laboratory animals to be done to as the researcher wishes. So that is participation. From participation, you can go on to engagement. Engagement is where researchers share the information, but usually after the fact, usually after doing the research, we tell them, here is what was done to you, and this was the result of the research that was done, and that is merely informing them. But involvement of the patient is where patients and the public work in partnership with the researchers at every single stage of the research, where you plan, design, manage, evaluate, and disseminate the research. And I shall better move faster a bit. So, when we talk of PPIE, to what extent do we involve these patients? Now, we said that it has to move from merely being a subject of the research. But to what extent? There is something called the ladder of participation, where how much citizens are involved in governing them in a society was looked at as far back as 1969. You don't need to write these down. If anyone wants the slides, you are welcome to have them. Please write to Kausho or myself. We'll be happy to disseminate the slides amongst you. Right. So, then this lady, Sherry Arnstein, explained that there are three different levels of involvement when people get involvement, people get involved in governing them. So the same thing can be applied to research as well. So the last or the bottom level, where there's no participation from their side, is where the researcher or the governing person manipulates the patient. You merely engage them through public relations, a PR exercise, just by, you know, giving them some money or giving them some incentive to participate in the research, you engage them into research. So that is curing or educating participants and manipulating them. That is not proper involvement in the research, and it is a non-participation, which is not, I'm sure you will agree, a good thing. Then the second level is where you get token involvement. Just a karanna ona nisa involve karaganna, a token, just as a token, that's all. There you inform the patients. Then you have a one-way flow of information, which is what I'm doing. I'm not getting anything back from you. I keep on talking because I need to get all this out within the next 10 minutes maximum. So a one-way flow of information where the researcher merely tells the research participant. And then you can do what is called a consultation. You do a survey and ask everyone's opinion. What do you think? Or you do what is called a public inquiry. You have public meetings and you just ask everyone's opinion. But that kind of placation allows the citizens or the people or the research participants to give their opinion. But that doesn't make it necessary for the researcher or the governing person to accept it. So always it is the governing person or the person in power, he has the ultimate decision-making ability. So it is only a token exercise in asking for their opinion. It doesn't really count because even though the patient or the public tells me this is what I want, I as the researcher or the person in power will say, oh yes, they said that, but that is not important. I have the power to do that. But moving on from tokenism to actual power is where you move into a partnership where you make shared decision making and shared responsibilities. But there's a problem with that as well, because the more you share responsibilities, one, it is time consuming. It costs money to involve people in it. And then, you know, everyone knows that too many cooks spoil the soup, right? So you have to be very careful when you involve patients to the level of partnership. Yes, it must be done, but it must be done carefully as well, because it is a time consuming, finances necessary are quite intense, and it has to be done with some discerning ability. Otherwise, you can end up with trying to implement everybody's ideas, which can make the research very difficult to actually do. So, this shows you the stages of PPIE. You can inform or consult, which is a low level of engagement. You can involve people, which is a middle level of engagement. Or you can go to the right to the high level of public engagement, where you actually get them to collaborate and to empower them. So this is again what I told you earlier. If you talk of educating and coercing, that is you are doing things to people. And in the middle level, you are doing things about them, but co-producing and co-designing, which is right at the top, is doing research with participants. And the importance of this comes here. Now, as you can see, the first step of public engagement here, the level, is informing. Can you see that the head is bigger here? One head is bigger. And it goes, the arrows go outside to the smaller head. So you have a big head, the researcher has a big head, he sends out things to the participants at the informing stage. But as you go on further, by the time you're consulting, your head is a little bit smaller, you are getting things in, you become a little less big-headed. And by the time you're actually collaborating and empowering them, you are all at the same level. You take the ideas of everyone, decide on the best methods to move forward, and make your research better that way. So when and where and how? How can research participants help and collaborate in the research? At every single stage of research, these people can, the patients and the public can participate. You help decide the topic of the research. Help with the application. Or you can help with this, and you can help with the study design, help disseminate the research, give feedback. All of that can be done, which you will hear more about in detail, which is why I'm skipping through quite fast here. Here's the research cycle. I'm repeating again. So when you're talking of identifying and prioritizing, you can hold a meeting with your research participants or with the public, and they can help you identify what is their critical problems, what is the type of question you should be asking, what will help them the most can be started by using a research user group or a patient participant group in your research. You can get them to give feedback and guide on projects from the patients themselves. You can get them to actually undertake the research themselves rather than a researcher asking the questions or carrying out the interviews. You can get the patients themselves who are involved in your research to ask the research questions, carry out the interviews. You can get patient researchers co-authoring and presenting at conferences, which you will hear about in a little while. And then afterwards, at the monitoring stage, they can help you identify what has gone right, what has gone wrong. This is an example, I just let this be, of how people have, all the different examples of how researchers have used PPIE groups to bring added value to their research. I have added this slide in so that when you are thinking about doing research yourselves, you can look at the examples of what has been done already and modify or update your research process accordingly based on that. Right, last one. Common reasons for failure. Now, doing PPIE is considered to be hard. It doesn't necessarily have to be hard, but it can fail due to many reasons. The first one is you're just merely trying to do it for the sake of, because your funders are asking for it, or because it is the new in and done kind of thing, and it is merely a token involvement. That doesn't work. If you don't really define what is your objective for the PPIE, if you don't have the time or the funding for it, and if you don't consider PPIE a priority and incorporate it right from the beginning of your research planning, it can very easily unravel and not work out in the way that you intended it. Then the last one is that the role of the PPIE members in research is unclear. If the PPIE people that you get, you ask patients to come in, and then if, very simply, if you ask patients to come in and if you use your jargon, if you keep on talking in medical terms that your patients and public people, lay people don't understand, they just won't be encouraged to participate in it further, right? If you speak in a language that they don't understand, if you all speak English and invite a non-English speaking person into your research group and tell them participate, you can be a co-presenter or whatever, they just won't have any interest in it. So you have to make it possible and feasible for them to participate as well. So these are the national standards for public involvement that England has put in place. It took them 20 years to do it. We can get there faster. We can also use these core concepts to adapt them to our requirements. The first one is that you have to give them inclusive opportunities. You have to give people the opportunity to be involved in a way that it is practical and feasible for them. For example, if you are looking at I used this example previously, autistic children. If you ask parents who don't have autistic children to be involved in your patient PPIE group, that is not going to add very much value to you because they won't know anything further. But if you involve a parent with an autistic child and if you ask that parent to come 5 days a week in the mornings to help you with your research, is that going to work? That is practically not possible. How is that mother going to actually look after that child? If you are doing something like that, you have to facilitate it in a way that the person can actually make use of it, right? If you have the meetings of PPIE group is a group of teachers, and if you every day schedule your meetings at 8 o'clock in the morning, they just can't come. It's not going to practically work, right? Then the second thing is communication. To use plain language, timely communications, and a two-way and targeted communication methods. Thirdly, working together to show mutual respect for the participants, the PPIE groups. If you have an attitude of I know best, you are just here and I will tell you what to do, they will not feel empowered participants in your research. Support and learning. If you involve a PPIE group in your research, say for example, we recently did some work on twin research. Now that's a very technical, scientific kind of research. So if you are involving a PPIE group in something like that, if you are discussing technical words, if you are discussing, for example, epidemiological methods of doing a research, you need to translate it into a way that these people can understand as well. Then governance. You have to include public in governance so that they know that your involvement, their involvement is valued. And lastly, the impact. You need to tell them, because you were involved in this research, our research was made better in these ways, and that is why we consider you valuable participants in this. If you don't give feedback, it is not an idea that will catch up. Lastly, this is what is called a framework for PPIE. It is an enhancement of the previous slide. It has a couple of other important things as well. Being conscious of confidentiality, right? You have to be conscious of the confidentiality of your patients. If they come and speak of their experiences, you need to respect that they may not want it discussed everywhere in a way that they can be identified. And the other important one here is that differentiating between public involvement activities and qualitative research. PPIE is not qualitative research. Qualitative research is again where you go and ask people about their experiences, yes, but you don't use that to change the way that you do research. Participants in the PPIE group are not research subjects. They are researchers themselves. They are co-participants in the research. You don't, for example, a very simple thing, to do a PPIE group, you don't need ethics approval. If you did qualitative research, you need an ERB approval, right? Ethics Review Committee has to approve it. Why? Because you are the researcher, they are the research subjects, and there is a power imbalance between the two of you, and you can abuse them. But when you are running a research user group or a PPIE group, they are at an equal level, same as you. They are not your subjects. You need to consider them as equal to you in your research process. And working sensitively is obviously a key requirement. Then, to finish off, PPIE seems to be thought of as something hard and difficult and very complicated. It doesn't need to be big and showy, and you don't have to have a huge, big show about doing PPIE. What it needs is that the PPIE needs to have a clear and coherent purpose. Why are you using the PPIE? And the researcher needs to have integrity and curiosity as to identifying what your research users actually need. So it may simply mean a few conversations with some users, some patients, to share an idea, share a question, share a problem, and identify the gaps in your knowledge that can help you formulate better research by knowing patient and public preferences better. So, It is all about talking to people to deepen your understanding and gaining their support to make research mutually beneficial. So that was all about PPIE. So I hope it was long enough to basically cover the subject matter and short enough to keep you interested to listen more in detail, which my colleagues will be talking about. The references for all that I spoke about are here. If anyone would like the slides, we'll be happy to disseminate them.
Good morning. Today, the changing society and pressures on health and related services have created a situation where the research is essential to discover evidence and treatments to cater to patients' needs and requirements to improve services. Exactly 1 year ago, in July 2018, at Sri Lanka Medical Association's SLMA's pre-Congress workshop, the internationally acclaimed concept of patient and public involvement and engagement in health research, PPIE, was formally introduced to Sri Lanka jointly by SLMA and Institute for Research and Development, IRD. Great concepts and good practices could be introduced. However, the real challenge is to identify a niche to operate and a working mechanism which is sustainable. We at IRD are exploring two-pronged strategy to implement PPIE. First and foremost, we are introducing the concept of PPIE to the senior scientists who are responsible for driving the research agenda as well as granting approval for research proposals as ethical review committee members. The other strategy is to sensitize patients and public, primarily using mass media. We have successfully networked with ethical review committees of Sri Lankan universities, leading hospitals, and other health sector educational institutions. The response from the ethical review committee members was encouraging, and within the last 12 months, we have organized 3 workshops enabling them to share with and gain from global champions in PPIE. The pool of expertise we put together created multiple stream of synergy and ignited live and constructive discussions. IRD incubates a virtual network which we call IRD PPIE Small Group, where the participants are encouraged to explore multiple dimensions of PPIE. The group members are from diverse backgrounds, which include law, human rights, disability studies, and medical sciences. IRD's own quarterly trilingual publication, Gaveshana, which is distributed free of charge among 700 public schools, continue to publish general articles on PPIE, which could be easily digested by students at the age group of 15 to 19. When those young Sri Lankans engage in their own research in years to come, it is expected that the concept of PPIE will blossom as an integral part of their research agenda. For the last 12 months, IRD sensitized Sri Lankan print and electronic media to introduce the concept of PPIE and to invite public at large to get involved. We received positive feedback, especially with interactive TV programs. IRD have identified volunteers who are keen and committed to be involved in research. Still, there are individuals who continue to question as to why a researcher should ask patients and their carers to contribute as equal partners in the research endeavor. In fact, When the concept was first introduced in Europe, many people were skeptical and inquired whether patients would be too emotionally involved. Will they be able to understand the scientific issues? Or will they be too narrow-minded in their personal interests? Sri Lanka is no exception. Some will continue to be skeptical. However, our PPIE experience has proved both our strategies, firstly with senior scientists and then with the general public, to have tangible impact. We are confident that Sri Lankan researchers will understand the added value of patient and public involvement, which contribute to a brighter world with better health and quality of life for all of us. There would not be research without research participants. And why not make them partners instead of making them just subject? Let's see how we can do it. Thank you. Over to you.
Thank you, Margaret. Good morning, everyone. My name is Kaushalya Jayavira. I'm the lead biomedical research coordinator at the Institute for Research and Development. So we've been doing a lot of PPIE work for the last 20 years, I would say, which was mostly involved in questionnaire adaptation and validation at, for epidemiological research. So what I'm going to do is something quite boring at the beginning, where we will tell you what we have done since the last SLMA workshop. Just a few pictures, then I'll tell you why we've done it. So so we had the SLMA pre-congress workshop last year. And then we, through that workshop, we created a professionals group, which involves clinicians, non-clinicians, who are working with us in all our research work now. Some of them are here. And then we had a five-day grant proposal writing workshop, where we actually wrote a grant for the Medical Research Council. And the beauty of that was we had a lot of academics from lots of international institutions, but we had our proposal was going to be on autism, neurodevelopmental disorders. So we had PPIE as a concept as well in it, and we had so lay people, Sister Anastasia from Diamina, and a lovely group of ladies from Reach Beyond who work with autistic children and who are mothers of autistic children. So that's how we involved PPIE in our research work, from the concept itself, from the inception where we create the research question. So then we also do engagement, where we do a lot of twin research work. So we engage twins through various cultural activities. And then we also went to the defense school in Colombo, where they have lots of twins. We did engagement activities there as well. And then we had a special PPIE workshop, especially for Ethics Review Committee members, to drive in the idea of why this is necessary in research. And we also had many more workshops. And we had a special two-day workshop in Rajaratnam University, where these lovely ladies who are here today to give you a presentation on what they've done, so they did a workshop for us. So as academics and researchers, we learned from them what they had done, and now we are trying to incorporate that in Colombo as well. Now this is all done in Rajaratnam. You hear about it soon enough from Dr. Dovinda and his team. And then we did a workshop for the Rajaratnam students, and then we went for a field visit as well. So all this you'll hear after tea. So why do we do this? Now, should we do it because the UK says it's best? It's what that sort of paternalistic as well. Why should we listen to them? Or should we do it because it's our moral and ethical obligation to do high quality research, which is community driven, which will benefit the community at the end? So it just won't be something in your CV. It won't be a publication in your CV. It won't be a thesis in Archie's Pettagama, because there's nothing more that can be done with it, because it's just something you did for your PGIM master's or doctoral thesis. But it can be something that can be useful for the community, it can be implemented, and it's used by everyone. And then it may be replicated in other regions as well. So that's why the importance of community-driven research is so valuable. It's so valuable because it comes from the community, they tell us our problems, we listen to them, we communicate with them, we try to understand what would be best for them, how we can help as academics with our methodological expertise. But then their expertise would come in different ways. Because we don't know the settings. Now we are doing a research project in Vaunia. I don't speak Tamil. I don't live in Vaunia. I have no idea what the setting is. I've been there. It's harsh. So I don't know what the ethical challenges there are. Because if I just go parachute in and do something, it's not going to work. People won't accept me. We've done the same thing in Putlam with Muslim communities. So we need to engage communities. We need to see what the communities need, what their problems are, how we can solve them. So you can divide basically research into four different groups. Curiosity-driven research, which is what's mostly done. So that's what drives our curiosity. We want to see what the hell this research is about. So we do conduct a research project. That's that. Then there's research for science implementation, so large-scale research for implementing policy implementation. Then there's commercially driven pharmaceutical research, things like that. But then there's nothing community-driven. So community-driven research, Dr. Dumin and his team will talk about. But that's the value of PPIE, involving and including people as equals. So we always include the community. Now these are lay people, they don't have any science background. Most of them have not been to school, most of them have some level of education. But the beauty of it is we learn from them. Because you can't just jump in and do research and expect it to beautifully implement it into the system, health system, and expect it to work, because it doesn't work like that. If you come up with an idea and say this is what maybe needs to be done, you will get some nice statistical output, some p-values, some nice publication, that's about it. But if you do something that the committee wants done, get them involved, see how we should engage the community, you'll have better participant engagement. You'll have better, more ethically sound research work coming out. And you'll have a research answer to your research question, which is highly more implementable than if you had not involved the community. So as Buddhika said, I'm going to reiterate again. Now the common trend is everyone wants PPIE. So this is the author's information section in the BMJ. So mandatory patient and participant involvement and reporting. Now publications want PPIE. So welcome trust grant funding applications, instructions for applicants, planning your public engagement. Medical Research Council, pathways to impact, again, public engagement. So everyone wants PPIE. So we've got two PPIE related grants, one specifically PPIE for involving the public from the Wellcome Trust back in 2008, and 2017 we got one as well. So again, we shouldn't do it because the West is biggest, because it's the in thing to do now, it's the fashion. We shouldn't do it like, we should do it because it's our ethical and moral obligation. So this is a very interesting article that's on Nature, which is titled A Better Measure of Research from the Global South. Here you see scientists who have created sort of a spray which goes on mangoes. This has been done in India. And it saves the mangoes from being crushed during transportation. This is so useful for the community, because now as people who are selling mangoes, it's useful for them. But as you can see at the top here, the scientists in the West, they mark it down as 1s and 2s and 0s because it's not important. So the question here is, should we do something to impress the West to get to get publications in high-impact journals such as Nature, Lancet, things like that? Or should we do research which will benefit the public? So I'm going to leave you with that and pray stop now so that the rest can go on and we can finish for tea. All right, so if you all have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. As Buddhika said, we'll share the slides with everyone. That's why we haven't given printouts. So, I'll end with that. Okay. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm very grateful to Professor Arthula Sumathipala and IRB team and the SLMA for this opportunity. Today I want to explain two things. PPIE in health promotion, Sri Lankan experiences, and follow-up work since 2018 SLMA pre-congress workshop. I think Kaush already presented that part. And I will explain the first part of my presentation. And we have invited a few committee members today to share their experiences. I think that's the most important thing. Ekenisa mage presentation ekama mama puluwan tarang keti karanna balanawa. Mokada apita field eke me experience thiyena aya villa inna nisa egollange wedipuru dewal apata aganna puluwan nisa. Basically, in all the work that we have been doing, not just in research, but also in interventions, and we have been giving priority and leadership to the public, or the communities, or the subjects that we work with in health promotion. So our work fits in naturally with the PPIE approach to research. So it goes little bit beyond in the sense that we not only involve people and engage the public, we also try to facilitate in their taking leadership as well. So some examples will be explained by the community members, but I will show you one video clip to show the process of this intervention. Before that, let me explain the background of these examples. And so main strategy is to plan and design the study with the community. And they were able to understand the determinants, and they were able to address the determinants, and also they were able to create the measurements to measure the process, not only the final impact. So they created process indicators as well, and we saw outcome were especially good because the people did their own research and the interventions. And the key to success of this intervention were lay people taking control over the condition that governed their life. So that is the key thing, and that is the main part of health, broad health promotion approach. And the examples which I want to give you in a minute, most of the people who involved in this intervention don't have high level of education, but they are educated in other ways, sometimes more educated than us, but their school based education qualifications were up to ordinary level or the below. And they have never been exposed to education on research methods, but they were interested and enthusiastic. The strength of this intervention is this is not a project or the research for them, but it is their life, and also subjects wanted to do it validly, sometimes more than the researchers. So I will show you one video clip. After that our committee members will explain you their experiences. Can I help you?
පරාසවල හිටියා මගේ බබත් හිටියා අඩු බරට අවදානමෙ බර අඩු වෙන්න හේතු මොනවද කියලා අපි බර කිරන් දෙන අම්මලා එකතු වෙලා සාකච්ඡා කරලා හෙව්වා අපි දරුවන්ගේ බර අඩු වීමට බලපාන හේතු කියලා හේතු හයක් හොයාගත්තා දරුවා සමග ගත කරන සැබෑ කාලය ආහාරවල පෝෂණය වගේම ප්‍රමාණාත්මකව ලැබෙනවාද පවුලේ කෙනෙක් හෝ පවුලේ බලපාන ළඟ ඥාතියෙක් රෝගී වීම පවුලේ ගැටුම් ඇතිවීම සැමියා මත්ද්‍රව්‍ය වලට මුදල් වැය කරනවාද ඒ ඔක්කොම වගේම සතුට කියන එක ගොඩාක් බලපානවා දරුවන්ගේ බර අඩු වීමට කියලා අපි හොයාගත්තා ඊට පස්සේ අපි කණ්ඩායම් හැදුණා අහල පහල අය පස් දෙනා ඊට පස්සේ මේ වගේ හාප් ෂීට් නිකන් කොලේක මේ චාට් එකක් ගහගෙන මේ මනින්න පටන් ගත්තා දරුවා සමග ගත කරන කාලය කොච්චරයිද ආහාරවල පෝෂණය ප්‍රමාණාත්මක දුන්නද කියලා අපි නිකම්ම මනින්න පටන් ගත්තා හිතේ හැටියට ලකුණු දුන්නා පහෙන් පහෙන් එහෙම ලකුණු දුන්නා ඊට පස්සේ ලකුණු වැඩි කියලා හිතන දවසට සතුට මූණකුත් ලකුණු සාමාන්‍යයි කියලා හිතන දවසට සාමාන්‍ය මූණකුත් ලකුණු අඩුයි කියලා අපට හිතුනහම දුක මූණකුත් ලකුණේ කරලා අපි හත්කයි කියලා හිතුනා අපිට කොල කොල එකතු කරන් ගියාම වදයක් කියලා ඊට පස්සේ අපි මේ වගේ ලස්සන පොතක් නිර්මාණය කරා ඊට පස්සේ මේ පොතේ තමයි අපි අරකේ තියෙන තොරතුරු මේ පොතට ගත්තා අපි හිතුවා මේ සතුට මූණ ගන්න වැඩි වුණොත් බබාගේ බර වැඩි වෙන්න ඕනේ දුක් මූණ ගන්න අඩු වුණොත් වැඩි දුක් මූණ ගන්න වැඩි වුණොත් බබාගේ බර අඩු වෙන්න ඕනේ කියලා ඊට පස්සේ බර කිරුවෙන් පස්සේ අපිට ඒක 100%ක් සාර්ථක වුණේ නැහැ අපි හෙව්වා මේකට මොකද හේතුව කියලා බලනකොට මානින ක්‍රමය එක එකන එක එක ආකාරයි එක අම්ම කෙනෙක් එළවලුවක් හදලා බබාගේ බඩ පිරෙන්න බත් කවලා ලකුණු පහක්ම දාගෙන තියෙනවා අපේ බබාද බඩ පිරෙන්නම බත් කෑවා කියලා තව අම්ම කෙනෙක් පෝෂ්‍ය පදාර්ථ ඔක්කොමත් එකතු කරලා පළතරකුත් කවලා අපේ බබාද අඩුවෙන් කෑවේ කියලා ලකුණු තුනක් දාගෙන තියෙනවා ඒ වාගේ අර මානින විදි බලන විදිය වෙනස් කියලා හිතුණා ඊට පස්සේ අපි මේ වාගේ නිර්ණායක හැදුවා දරුවා සමග ගත කරන කාලය කියන එකට අපි නිර්ණායක හැදුවා උදෑසන අවදි වීමට ලකුණු භාගයයි රූපවාහිනී බලන වෙලාව අඩු කළා නම් ලකුණු 1යි නිවසේ බඩු අහුර ඇති ආකාරයට ලකුණයි නින්දට යන වෙලාවට ලකුණු භාගයයි නිවසේ අන්නයිගේ සහයෝගය ලබා ගැනීමට ලකුණු 2යි මේ විදිහට නිර්ණායක හැදුවා නිර්ණායකට අනුව ලකුණු දුන්නා ඊට පස්සේ ලකුණු වලට අනුව අපි මේ මූණු මාක් කරේ ලකුණු 18ට වඩා වැඩි වුණොත් මේ ලකුණු 18ට වඩා ඒ දවසේ වැඩි වුණොත් සතුට මූණකුත් 18ත් 12ත් අතර නම් මේ වගේ සාමාන්‍ය මූණකුත් 12ට අඩු වෙනත් දුක් මූණකුත් අපි ලකුණු කරා ලකුණු අඩු වෙනවා කියලා තේරුණා අපිට ඊට පස්සේ ඒක නැති කරන්න ලස්සන ක්‍රම ගොඩාක් භාවිතා කරා ඒ තුලින් තුරස්භාවය නැති කරා තුරස්භාවය නැතිවීම තුලින් මේ ලකුණු වැඩි වුණා සතුට මූණ ගන්න වැඩි වුණා සතුට මූණ ගන්න වැඩි වීම තුලින් බර වැඩි වුණා කියන සතුටුයි මගේ බබාගේ ප්‍රියාවලිය පටන් ගත්ත පළවෙනි මාසේ ග්‍රෑම් 800ක් වැඩි වෙලා තිබුණා මේක අපේ මිස්ට නම් හිතා ගන්න බැරි වුණාද මන්ද අපේ මිස් මගේ බබාව දෙසරයක් නෙවෙයි තුන් සැරයක් දාලා කිරුවා මමත් හොඳට බලන් හිටියා ඊට පස්සේ මට ඒත් හිතා ගන්න බෑ වගේ මම ගෙදර අරන් ඇවිල්ලා කඩයක් තියෙන මේක ඉලෙක්ට්‍රික් බැලන්ස් එකක් තියෙනවා මම ඕකේ තියලා බැලුවා බලනකොට හරි අපි මේ ක්‍රියාවලිය පටන් ගත්තේ කණ්ඩායම් තුනකින් ඊට පස්සේ මේ මගේ අනිත් කණ්ඩායම් තුනේම හිටපු අයගේ ග්‍රෑම් 600 400 500 වැඩි වුණා අනිත් අයත් මේ සඳහා මේ ගමේ හිටපු අනිත් අයත් එකතු වුණා
what can we learn from them මොනවද අපිට ඒගොල්ලන්ගෙන් ඉගෙන ගන්න පුළුවන් උනාර්ධයක් තියෙනවද අපිට ඒගොල්ල රිසර්ච් එහෙම බැලුවොත් අපිට ඉගෙන ගන්න පුළුවන් දේවල් ඒ ඉන්ටර්වෙන්ෂන් එකේ යමක් තියෙනවද අපිට ඉගෙන ගන්න දැන් రీసెర్చర్స్ల విధిట අපි සමහරලාවට අපි පක්කරි ඉන්ටර්වෙන්ෂන් එකක් කරනකොට මනින විදිහේ ගැටලුවක් ආවොත් අපි ආපහු ආපස්සට ගිහිල්ලා ඒක හරි ගස්ස ගන්න බලමු. So they did the same. Sometimes accurately and validly. ඒ කියන්නේ අපිට වඩා සමහර වෙලාවට හොඳින් බලන්නම වෙන්න පුළුවන් බලනවා මොකද ඒක ඒගොල්ලන්ගේ දරුවගේ ප්‍රශ්නයක් නිසා. එතකොට මම හිතන්නේ අපි ඒ උදාහරණ වලින් ඉගෙන ගන්න දේවල් ගොඩක් තියෙයි. නමුත් අපිට තියෙන කාලෙත් එක්ක අපි බලමු ඩිස්කෂන් එක වලදී ඉගෙන කතා කරන්න. Now I will invite our community members to present their or share their experiences. අපි ඕගොල්ලන්ට එන්න කියන අපේ මේ ප්‍රජාවේ කණ්ඩායමට මේ කණ්ඩායම අපිත් එක්ක I will tell you the background of this group. මේ කණ්ඩායම අපිත් එක්ක 2010 අවුරුද්දේ ඉඳන් සමහර අය සම්බන්ධ වෙනවා. එතකොට ඒ කාලේ ඉඳන් ඒගොල්ලන්ගේ ගම්වල කරපු දේවල් අපිත් එක්ක බෙදා ගනි. මැදවච්චි ඉඳලා ඒගොල්ලෝ ඇවිල්ලා තියෙන ඊර ඕචි ඇවිල්ලා අද උදේ මේ බැලලා මේ වෙනුවෙන්මයි මේ සඳහා ඇවිල්ලා තියෙන්නේ. ඒගොල්ලන්ට කියන්න දේවල් ගොඩක් තියෙයි. නමුත් මේ කාලේ අඩු නිසා අපි ඉල්ලීමක් කරනවා ඔයගොල්ලන්ගෙන් පුළුවන් තරම් කෙටියෙන් තමන්ගේ අත්දැකීම් ටික ඉදිරිපත් කරන්න කියලා.
කරගන්නේ කොහොමද කියලා තමයි අපි බැලුවේ. ඉතින් මුලින්ම අපි
අපිට පුළුවන් දේ තමයි අපි තෝරගත්තේ මුලින්ම මම ඒක කියන්නා මේ ගංගක්කට මම මේ අවස්ථාව දෙන්නම් ගම්මි කොහොමද අපි මුලින්ම තෝරගත්ත දේ අපි කරේ කියන එක කියන්න
පොඩර් ප්‍රශ්න තිබුණා අමුදේකටම මට හිතුණා මේ අපේ ගම මැදවැත්තේ කොට්ටාසෙන් ගත්තහම හැම පැත්තින්ම දුර්වල ගමක් 2010 වෙනකොට දරුවෝගේ බර පොඩි දරුවෝගේ බිංදුවක් පහක් අතර දරුවෝගේ බර ගත්තහම අඩුම PHM ඒරියා එක ඒ වගේම බුද්ධි වර්ධනයෙන් අඩු දරුවෝ ගත්තහම ඒත් ඒ වගේ මට පවා සමහරට පාරේ යද්දී ඇඟිලි දික් කළා කියන ආන්නාර මෝඩ ගමින් බැඳලා ඉන්නේ මේ විදිහයි කියලා. ඉතින් හරි දුකයි. හැමතැනම ගියාම මේ ගොඩක් අර මේ එක එක මේ සමච්චලයට හැම වාදිනේ වෙනවා. ඉතින් මේ වැඩසටහනත් එක්ක මේ මට හිතුණා අපි අපේ ගම කොහොම හරි වෙනස් කරන්න ඕනේ කියලා. ඊට පස්සේ අපි එකතු වෙලා අන්තිම හොයාගත්තා මේ වට මොනවද හේතු කියලා මේ වැඩසටහනත් එක්ක. ඉතින් 2010 වෙනකොට ගොඩ අපේ ගම්වල තිබුණේ අඩුපාඩු අපි හොඳටම අපේ ඇස්වලින් අපි දැක්කා. ඒවා අපි ගිහිල්ලා මහ ලොකුට රැස්වීම් තියතිය මේවා කර කර අම්මලාට කතා කර කර කිය කිය එහෙම අපි කියන්නේ අපි දෙන්නේ තුන් දිනක් එකතු වෙලා තමයි අපි හෙව්වේ ඇයි අපි දරුවන්ගේ බර අඩු වෙන්නේ. අනිත් PHM ඒරියා වල වැඩ කරනකොට මිස්ලා සතුටින් වැඩ කරගෙන යනවා. අපේ PHM ඒරියා එක දෙනකොට මාසයයි දෙකයි එමිස් එපා කියලා දාලා යනවා. ඉතින් අපිට හරි දුකයි. දරුවෝ 40ක් ගත්තාම දරුවෝ 15ක් 20ක් විතර වගේ බර අඩුයි. ඉතින් අපිම හේතු හොයලා බැලුවා ඒ වට. ඉතින් ඒ වගේ මේ ලියන්නත් පටන් ගත්තා අම්මලා. ඒවා දැන් අර ගොඩක් තියෙනවා
මේ කන්නේ ගමේ සිටියම යන්නේ නැත්තම් දන්නේ නැහැ අපි මේ ගමේ ගිහිල්ලා දැන් කතා කරාම කොයි වගේද දේවල් තියෙන්නේ කියලා දන්නේ නැහැ. ඊපස්සට හඳුනා ගන්න තමයි අපි සියලු දෙනාම එකතු වෙලා මේ වගේ සිටියමක් ගමේ ඇඳගත්තා. අපි දන්න විදිහට මේකේ තියෙන හැම දෙයක්ම බොන්නේ අරක්කු බොන්නේ කවුද බර අඩු ළමයි කවුද රණ්ඩු දබර පවුල් කවුද කියලා මේකෙන් අපිට හඳුනා ගන්න පුළුවන්. ඒ මේ තමයි සිටියම.
ඒ වගේ අම්මලා දැන් පටන් ගත්තා ඒ දරුවෝගේ බර වැඩි කරගන්න. දැන් කතා කරන්නේ කිහාම අපිට දවසක් විතර යයි එක දෙයක් වෙනුවෙන් අපි මොනවද කරේ කියලා මම කෙටියෙන් ඔයාලට අපි මේ කරේ මොනවද කියලා කතා කරන්නේ. ඒ වගේ මේ බුද්ධි වර්ධනී මඩු දරුවෝ ගත්තහම මම කිව්වා අපේ ගමේ තමයි වැඩිපුරම මටත් ලැජ්ජයි. දැන් 2010 පටන් ගන්නකොට ඒ හිටිය දරුවෝ අද ඉන්නව 6 වසරේ. ඔයාලට ඕනනම් ගිහිල්ලා ඔයලා බලන්න පුළුවන් පුණෑව අද ඉසිපතන විද්‍යාලයේ 6 පන්තියේ 1 ඉඳලා 10ට යන ඒ කණ්ඩායමේ අහම්බුලේස පන්නේ එක්කිනේ දෙන්නෙක් වගේ තමයි 1 ඉඳලා 10 වෙනියට ගන්න අතර ඒ අතරේ 1 ඉඳලා පන්තියේ 30 40 ඒ වගේ අර ලකුණු ගන්න ළමයි කොටස කඩලා ඉන්නවා. මගේ ගමේ දරුවෝ 15ක් යනවා ඒ ඉස්කෝලේට. මම පුදුම සතුටක් ලබනවා. හැබැයි අනිත් ගම්වල අය අපිත් එක්ක තරහයි. ඇයිදිනු ස්ටේජ් එකේ ගිහිල්ලා දකින්නේ මාර දරුවෝ. දැස්වීමක ගිහිල්ලා දකින්නේ මේ දරුවෝ. ඔය වාස තරඟ වලට එහෙම ගිහිල්ලා දකින්නේ මේ දරුවෝ. අපිට ඇඟිලි දික් කළා දැන් කියන්නේ අපිට ඔයාලා ගමත් එක්ක හරි තරහයි. ඇයිදිනු මොනවට හරි ගියාම වැටිපුර ඇහෙන්න ඔයාලගේ ගමේ නම. ඉතින් ඒ නිසා දැන් ඒ පැත්තින් ගොඩ සතුට වෙනවා. ඒ වගේම බර අඩු දරුවෝ අපේ ගමේ නෑ. දරුවෝ 42ක් ඉන්නවා. එකම එක දරුවෙක් ඉන්නවා බර අඩු. ඒත් උත්තේ බර අඩු දරුවෙක් නෙමෙයි. ඒ වගේ මේ ගොඩාක් වෙනස්කම් තියෙනවා. තව අපේ මේ සහෝදරයෝ ඉන්න නිසා ඒගොල්ලන්ට පොඩි පොඩි අවස්ථාවක් දෙන්න ඕනේ.
දැන් අපි මේවා සටහන් කරනවා. මේ තමයි අපි ගම්වල වෙනස් වෙලා ඉන්න අය. මේ තමයි මෙහෙම අපි ඒවා පොත්තරට ගන්නවා අපි කරන දේවල්. ඒව තමයි මේ තියෙන්නේ. ඒ වගේම දැන් අපි ගෙවල් වලට ගිහිල්ලා අම්මලා තාත්තලා සම්බන්ධතර වෙන පවුල් දිනනවා. අම්මත් එක්ක වෙනම කතා කරනවා, තාත්තත් එක්ක වෙනම සාකච්ඡා කරනවා. මේ දේවල් අපි මේ වගේ සටහන් කරනවා මේ පොත්වල. තනියම නෙමෙයි මේක කරන්නේ, අපි සියලු දෙනාම තමයි එකතු වෙලා මේ දේ කරන්නේ. ඒ දේවල් තමයි මේ තියෙන්නේ. ඒ වගේම තව ලොකු දෙයක් වෙනවා සායන වලට යන ප්‍රමාණය මං කියන ගමේ වැඩි කියලා ඒකට උදාහරණයක් ලෙස මේ අක්කා මේ ගෑයි මේ කියන්නේ එයාගේ වෙච්ච වෙනස්ක
මේක මම හිතන්නේ ටිකක් සුවිශේෂයි මෙච්චර කල් අපි ගොඩක් වැඩ කරේ පබ්ලික් සාමාන්‍ය අයත් එක්ක නමුත් PPIE එකේ තියෙන patients ලත් එක්ක රෝගී වෙච්ච අයත් එක්ක හොවා වැඩ කරන එක මේ උදාහරණෙදී මෙතුමිය මම හිතන්නේ සායනෙට යන ගමන් සායනය ඉන්න අයව මේ වෙනස් කිරීම සඳහා දායක කරගත්තා ඒක පොඩ්ඩක් අපිට කියන්න පුළුවන් සර් මුදනාරසු බොහෝ
ඇසනාකි මේ තමයි මගේ ක්ලිනික් පොත මම 2014 ඉඳලා තමයි මම ක්ලිනික් යන්න පටන් ගත්තේ මම අසනීප ගොඩාක් තිබ්බ කෙනෙක් ඊට පස්සේ මේ කට්ටිය එකතු වෙලා ගමේ මෙහෙම වැඩසටහනක් කරගෙන යනවා කියලා මට ආරංචි වුණා ඊට පස්සේ මමත් ගිහිලා මං ඇහුවා මේ නම් ඉගෙන අපිට පුළුවන්ද මේ වැඩසටහනට සහභාගී වෙන්න කියලා එයාලා කිව්වා නමක් නැහැ එන්න ඇවිල්ලා ඔයාලට කරන්න පුළුවන්ද ඔයාට කරන්න පුළුවන්ද කියලා බලන්න බලලා අපිත් එකතු වෙලා වැඩ කරන්න කියලා ඇත්තටම මම ඊට පස්සේ මම එයාලත් එක්ක එකතු වෙලා වැඩ කරන්න පටන් ගත්තට පස්සේ මම රාගම තමයි මේ ක්ලිනික් ආවේ ඊට පස්සේ මම දැන් මනෝවිද්‍යාල ක්ලිනික් එක දාලා තියෙනවා මම දැන් ක්ලිනික් යන්නේ නැහැ ඒ කියන්නේ මොකද මානසික මට්ටම හොඳට තියෙනවා නම් අපි කොච්චර දේවල් කීවත් කරුවත් බෙහෙත් බිව්වත් ඒක වැඩක් නැහැ මානසික මට්ටම හොඳට තියෙනවා නම් මේ හැම ලෙඩකටම චුට්ටක් හරි මේ රුකුලක් වෙනවා දැන් මගේ මල්ලි මට ඉඳලා ආවේ මම මේ මගේ පවුල ගැන මම මේ කියන්නේ මම පවුලෙන් එහාට යන්න ඉස්සරින් මගේ පවුල හදාගෙන ඉන්න ඕනේ ඉතින් ඊට පස්සේ එයා මේ රට ඉඳලා ආව පස්සේ යා පවුල පසුබිම චොට්ටක් අවුල් වෙලා තිබුණා ඊට පස්සේ එයාට සීනි හැදුණා ඊට පස්සේ මම බැලුවා දැන් මේක ඇයි මෙයාට මෙහෙම වෙන්න හේතුව ඇයි මොකද මෙහෙම වුනේ කියලා හොයලා බලනකොට මෙයාට පොඩි පොඩි ගැටලු ටිකක් තිබුණා ඊට පස්සේ අපි ඒක කතා කරලා මේ ඒකට විසඳුම් ටිකක් හොයාගත්තට පස්සේ එයාගේ සීල් තත්ත්වය අඩු 295 තිබ්බා මල්ලිගේ සීල් තත්ත්වය දැන් එයා රට යන්න ලෑස්ති ඉතින් මගෙත් මේ 100 ගණන් වලට ප්‍රෙෂර් එක තිබුණා දැන් මේ මගේ තව ඉන්න සහෝදර සහෝදරියෝ ටිකක් එකතු කරගෙන මං එයාලගේ කොට් ටික ගෙනත් දෙනවා ඔබතුමීලාට බලන්න නම් මේ වෙලාවක් නැති ඇති බලන්න නම් බලන්නත් පුළුවන් අපි මම දැන් ওই සායනෙට ගියාට පස්සේ එක්කෙනෙක් දෙන්නෙක් එක කතා කරගත්තා කතා කරගෙන අපි දැන් මේ අලසක මින් හම්මැලි කමින් බෙහෙත් ටිකම බීලා ඉන්නවා කියලා හිතේ තියාගෙන හිටියට ඒක කොහොමඩවත් කරන්න බැහැ. චුට්ටක් ව්‍යායාමයක් කරන්න ඕනේ. චුට්ටක් හිනහා වෙලා සතුටින් සන්තෝෂෙන් ඉන්න ඕනේ. කෑම බීම චුට්ටක් වෙනස් කරන්න ඕනේ. ඒ වගේ ගොඩ දේවල් තියෙනවා. බෙහෙත් වලින්ම අපි මේක වෙනස් කරනවා කියලා හිතාගෙන හිටියොත් කවදාවත් මේක වෙනස් කරන්න බැහැ. ඒ කියන්නේ මගේ මේ අත්දැකීම් මං කියන්නේ මගේ දුව එක්කෙනයි ඉන්නේ. මේ තමයි මේ වගේ අපි මේ තෙල් මේ පන ප්‍රමාණය අඩු කරගත්ත විදිහ මේ තියෙන්නේ ඉස්සර කිසිම ප්‍රමාණයක් තිබ්බේ නැහැ බෝතල් පිටිවක් කරගෙන මේ ප්‍රමාණයක් නැතුව හැම දෙයක්ම තෙල් පාවිච්චි කරා ඒ වගේ අපි ඊට පස්සේ හැම ගෙදරකටම කියලා දුන්නා මේ විදිහට පාවිච්චි කරන්න බෝතලේ ගහගන්න එතකොට තමන් ප්‍රමාණයක් තියනවා මේ පාවිච්චි කරන දැන් එතකොට අපි දන්නවා දැන් මෙච්චර ප්‍රමාණයක් යනවා මේ ප්‍රමාණය අඩු කරගන්න ඕනේ කියන එක මේකෙන් සඳහන් කරගන්න පුළුවන්. ඒ විදිහට තෙල්, සීනි, පිටි ඒ වගේ කෑම ජාති වලින් ගොඩාක් අඩු කරගෙන ඉන්න හින්දා මේ ලෙඩ රෝග වලින් ගොඩක් මේ ඈත් වෙලා ඉන්න පුළුවන්. මේ අපි මේ දත් අරගෙන තියෙනවා.
මේ තමයි අපි සීනි, තෙල්, ලුණු පාවිච්චි කරපු 2011 ඉඳලා 2018 වෙනකන් තියෙනවා. ඇත්තටම ගොඩක් සතුටු වුණා අපි කොච්චර ප්‍රමාණයක් අපට අඩු කරගන්න පුළුවන් වුණාද කියන එක. ඒ කියන්නේ මුලින්ම අපිත් දන්නේ නැහැ 2011 අපිට ගිහිල්ලා තියෙනවා පොල්තෙල් ලීටර් 6000ක් ගමේ පොල්තෙල් ලීටර් 6000ක් ගිහිල්ලා තියෙනවා. ඇත්තට මේක දකින්නකොට අපි ගිහිල්ලා බලනකොට තමයි අපටත් තේරෙන්නේ මෙච්චර අපි කාලා තියෙනවාද කියලා. 2018 ඒකේ භාගයක්ම අඩු වෙලා. ඒ කියන්නේ ඒක අපිට කියාගන්නත් ඇත්තටම බෑ. ඒ වගේම තමයි ලුණු. ලුණු 2011 අපි කාලා තියෙනවා 1680ක් කාලා තියෙනවා ලුණු පැකට් යන්නේ කිලෝ 1680ක් පාලා තියෙනවා 2018 වෙනිදා 520යි ඒ කියන්නේ මුළු අවුරුද්දටම ඒක
මේ මුළු ගමේම නේ
මුළු ගමේම ඊපස්සේ එහෙම අපි කරන ගමන්ම දැන් අපේ ගමයි තව මේ වැඩසටහන නොකරන ගමකුවේ සංසන්දනය කරලා බලුවා කොහොමද වෙනස කියලා. දැන් අපිම විතරක් වෙනස් වෙලා බෑනේ. තව මේ වැඩසටහන නොකරන ගමකට ගියා අපි. ගිහිල්ලා එයාලත් එක්ක සාකච්ඡා කරා. ඒ සාකච්ඡා කරන වෙලාවේ අපි මේ වගේ සටහන් කරගත්තා. මේ පොත්වල තියෙනවා ඒවා. සටහන් කරගත්තා එයාලා කොහොමද ලුණු භාවිතා කරන්නේ කියලා. තෙල් භාවිතා කරන්නේ කියලා. ඒ වගේ මේ මෙහිම සටහන් කරගත්තට පස්සේ අපට තේරුණා දැන් අපේ ගමේ යන්නේ පොල්තෙල් ලීටර් 2යි මාසෙකට ඒ ගමේ ලීටර් 4ක් යනවා.
එක
ගෙදරක. දැන් ඉස්සර අපිත් ඇත්තටම දන්නේ නැහැ පොලිය අරගෙන මෙහෙම දානවා. එහෙම ගාණක් නැහැ. මේ තියෙන්නේ සීනි ප්‍රමාණය සීනි භාවිතය ඒ කියන්නේ එක ගෙදරක අපේ යන්නේ සීනි කිලෝ 2ක්. මේ අනෙක් ගමේ යනවා සීනි කිලෝ 7ක්. සමහර ගෙවල් තියෙනවා සීනි කිලෝ 7ටත් වැඩිය යනවා.
කියන්නේ මුළු ගමේම ලුණු භාවිතය සීනි භාවිතය අඩු කරගෙන
තියෙනවා. මුළු ගමේම තමයි මේ කියන්නේ මම. ඒ ගමේ අපි ගියා ගෙවල් 10ක 15කට විතර ගිය ගම අපිට අඩුම ගාන තමයි අපි මේ දාලා සමහරක් ගෙවල් වලින් කියනවා 12ක් යනවා කියනවා 7ක් යනවා කියනවා 8ක් යනවා කියන හැම කියනවා ඒවා තමයි වැඩිපුරම කියපු දේ තමයි මේක සටහන් කරගත්තේ ඒ ගමෙන්.
මුතුමීට මොනවද?
සියලු දෙනාගෙන්ම අවසරයි. මගේ නම් සඳමාලි ලියනගේ. මම නම් ඔයාලට කියන්න යන්නේ වෙනස්ම විදියක දෙයක්. මගේ පවුල වෙනස් කරගන්න හැටි මම වෙනස් වෙච්ච හැටි තමයි මම ඔයාලට කියන්න යන්නේ. මේ වැඩසටහනට මම නම් ගොඩක් පරණ නැහැ. ගිය අවුරුද්දේ මැදහරියට තමයි සම්බන්ධ වුණේ. වැඩසටහනට සම්බන්ධ වෙන්න කලින් මට ගොඩාක් ප්‍රශ්න තිබිච්ච කෙනෙක්. මම ගොඩාක් මහත්තයෙක් හිටියා. මගේ මහත්තයා මාව කසාද බඳලා අවුරුදු 16ක් වෙනවා. මට මගේ මහත්තයාගේ සිගරට් බීම, බීඩි බීම, අරක්කු බීම නතර කරගන්න බැරුව හිටියා. මගේ දුවල දෙන්නෙක් ඉන්නවා. දැන් එක්කෙනෙක් පෙර පාසල්, අනිත් කෙනා 6 වසරේ. දරුවන්ටත් මගේ තරබාරුකමයි, කම්මැලිකමයි, මට තිබිච්ච ලෙඩ රෝගය එක්ක මාව එපා වෙච්ච තත්ත්වයක් තිබ්බා. මගේ මහත්තයාටත් මාව එළවන්න බැරි නම්ට මාව තියන්නපු තත්ත්වයක් තමයි මගේ ගෙදර තිබ්බේ. මගේ මහත්තයා පෞද්ගලික ආයතනයක වැඩකදී මාස් පඩි ගත්තේ. මං ගොඩාක් කම්මැලිකමෙන් තවම බේකරියක් තියෙනවා. මාසේ කෑම වියදම ෂේප් කරන්නේ මම අර බේකරියෙන්. මාසෙකට රුපියල් 6000ක 7000ක මම මේ පාන් විතරක් කනවා. පාන් පිටි කාල කරලා ගොඩාක් මහත්තයෙක් හිටියා. මේ වැඩසටහනට අපේ මේ ගාංගක් වගේ පළවෙනි වැඩසටහනකට මම අහම්බෙන්ම ගියා. ඒ ගියාට පස්සේ මට හිතුණා මේ වැඩසටහන හොඳයි, මටත් වෙනස් වෙන්න පුළුවන්, මටත් මොකක් හරි සහනයක් මේකෙන් ලබා ගන්න පුළුවන් කියලා. ඊට පස්සේ මම මගේ ගෙදර අයටත් කියලා කියලාම එයාලත් දැන් මං කියන දේ පිළිගන්නේ නැති මට්ටමක හිටියා. මං හිතුවා මං වෙනස් වෙනවා කිසි කෙනෙක්ට කියන්නේ නැතුව කියලා. මං වෙනස් වෙන්න පටන් ගත්තා. මං හැම මාසෙම මගේ බර කිරන්න ගත්තා. මං කිලෝ 80කටත් වැඩිය බර වැඩි වෙලා හිටියා. 85ක් 86ක් වගේ බර තිබ්බා. පස්සේ මම එක එක මගේ ගෙදර වෙනස්කම් එක එක කරන්න ගත්තා. ඉස්සෙල්ලා කිරිපිටි පාවිච්චිය. කිරිපිටි පාවිච්චිය මම අඩු කරගත්තා. මම හැමදේයක්ම පටන් ගත්ත දවසේ ඉඳලාම දත්ත සටහන් කරන්න ගත්තා. කිරිපිටි පාවිච්චිය මම අඩු කරලා ඒක නැත්තරම නැති කර අපි දැන් කිරිපිටි පාවිච්චි කරන්නේ නැහැ. ලුණු මම අත්තේ ලුණු පැකට් එක මෙහෙම අහුලා අරගෙන තමයි හොදිමාළු වලට දැම්මේ. ඒකත් ගොඩක්ම අඩු කරලා දැම්මයි යෝගට් ඇඳක් තමයි පාවිච්චි කරන්නේ. මාසෙකට සීනි කිලෝ 7ක් පාවිච්චි කළා මම ඉස්සෙල්ලා. දැන් සීනි කිලෝ එකමාරකට ඒව ගස්සගෙන තියෙනවා. ඊට පස්සේ මගේ මහත්තයාට හැමදාම
පීඩිසිකයක් වුණු මම නෑදිය තිබ්බා මගේ කම්මැලිකමත් එක්ක වියදමත් වැඩි වුණා මං හවසට කඩේක බඩු කිරන්න ගියත් ඇයතුනකට රුපියල් 300ක් ගන්නවා රුපියල් 300 මහත්තයාගේ පීඩිමිති දෙකයි මගේ දරුවන්ට චොකි චොක්ලට් බිස්කට් තමයි මං ගෙදරට ගෙනාවේ පීඩිමිතිය ගේන්න අමතක වෙච්ච දවස් දෙක තුනකම මගේ මහත්තයා රෑ 10:00 මාව එළියට දාලා තියනවා ගිහින් පීඩි හොයන්න එන්න කියලා ඉතින් ඒ මම මේ වැඩසටහන කරන්න පටන් ගත්තට පස්සේ
සුටි සමාවෙන මේ වෙලාව නිසා පොඩ්ඩක් මේ මොනවද කියලා චුට්ටක් පැහැදිලි කරන්න පුළුවන්ද
මේ වැඩසටහන කරන්න පටන් ගත්තට පස්සේ මම ගෙදර ආයේ සහයෝගය ගන්න මේ සහයෝගිතා කැලෙන්ඩරය කියලා හැදුවා මම තනියෙන් වැඩ කරද්දි ගෙදර ආයේ උදව් ගන්න මේකේ මේ ගෙදර කට්ටියගේ නම් තියෙනවා මං මට කරලා දෙන්න ඕන උදව් තියෙනවා මේ නවුම කරකැවුවට පස්සේ ගෙදර අය තමන්ට වැටෙන උදව්ව කරලා දෙනවා මුලින් නම් අකමැති වුණා දැන් නම් මේක හරි සතුටින් කරනවා මට මගේ වැඩත් පහසු වුණා අපි මේකට සහයෝගිතා කරන්නනේ කියලා තමයි කියන්නේ මම මෙහෙම වැඩ කරන්න ගත්තට පස්සේ මගේ ගෙදරට කට්ටිය එනවා මේ අපි මව් කවුරු හදාගත්තා ඒ එන අයට මං කරපු වැඩ මගේ ගෙදර තත්ත්වය කොහොමද කියලා අපිව මනින්න කොහොමද මේ අපි මේ වැඩ කරන විදිය හොඳයිද අපේ පවුල සතුට පවුලද අපිව මනින්න මේ මනින්න කැලෙන්ඩරයක් හැදුවා මේ මගේ සතුට කැලෙන්ඩරේ පවුලේ සතුට මම මේ සතුට කැලෙන්ඩරේ මගින් ගොඩාක්ම වැඩි කරගත්තා ඇත්තටම මුල්ම දවස්වල ගොඩාක් දුකෙන් අපේ ඉදර ඉඳපු දවස් ගන්න වැඩි දැන් එහෙම දවසක් මාසෙකට එකක් නැත්තම් දෙකක් හොයාගන්න අමාරුයි මගේ ගෙදරට ගොඩක් අය පැමිණෙනවා ඒ එන අය මගේ දරුවන්ට කඩ කෑල්ලේ අරගෙන එනවා මම ඒක සීමා කරන්න කැලෙන්ඩරයක් හැදුවා හදර සාලෙම එල්ලුවා මේක ගෙදරට එන අය කේන දේවල් ලියනවා කේන දේ මම ගේන කෙනාගේ නමත් එක්ක ඉස්සරහින් හොඳ දේද නරක දේද කියලා ලියනවා මේ එහෙම ගෙනාවම මේක දැක්කම සමහරු අහනවා ඇයි මේක මෙහෙම කරන්නේ කියලා ඉතින් අපි කරන වැඩසටහනත් එක්ක ඉතින් එයාලට විස්තරය කිව්වට පස්සේ කිසි කෙනෙක්ගේ හිත රිදෙන්නේ නැහැ ස්වාභාවික දේවල් විතරයි මගේ ගෙදරට ගේන්නේ කඩ කෑම කිසි දෙයක් දැන් කිසි කෙනෙක් මගේ ගෙදරට අරගෙන එන්නේ නැහැ සේ මගේ පෙර පාසල් යන දුවට මම බුද්ධි වර්ධනය සඳහා බුද්ධි වර්ධන පොත හැදුවා එයාගේ පංචේන්ද්‍රියට කන්න දීම ඒ හැම දත්තයක්ම සටහන් කරනවා අපේ බුද්ධි වර්ධනය සඳහා බුද්ධි පොහොර ලබා දෙනවා මම මගේ දුවට ලබා දෙනවා හාල් මැස්සන් ඔළු කුඩු කළා මුරුංග කොළයි හාල් මැස්ස ඔළුයි ධාන්‍ය වර්ගයකට කුඩු කළා දවසකට ඒ හැන්ද බැගින් මේ බුද්ධි පොහොර කියලා අපි ලබා දෙනවා
සමාවෙන්න මේ වෙලාව මදි නිසා මොකක් හරි විශේෂ දෙයක් තියෙනවද ගංගා
අපි දැන් අපේ චූටි දරුවෝයි අපි මේ ඉස්කෝලේ යම් දරුවෝ ගැන වැඩි අවධානයක් දාන්න වෙන්නේ නැති නිසා අපි මිතුරු හමුව තියලා දරුවෝ වෙනුවෙන් ආය එකතු වුණා මේ දරුවෝ සතියකට පාරක් එකතු වෙනවා මේ මිතුරු හමුව කියන එකට විශේෂ මාතෘකාවක් දානවා අපිට අර බුද්ධි වර්ධනය ගැන මම මුලින් කතා කරපු දෙයක මේ ඒ ලොකු දරුවොත් මේකට එකතු වෙනවා දැන් මේ දරුවන්ගේ විශේෂත්වය දැන් ගිය වාර විභාගයට වඩා මේ වාර විභාගයේ ලකුණු වැඩි කරගන්න එක. එතකොට මේ එයාලා සමිති හදාගෙන තියෙනවා සතියෙන් සතියට එකතු වුණාම සාකච්ඡා කරන කරුණු. එතකොට පස් දෙනෙක් වගේ එකතු වුණාම ඒ පස් දෙනා අතර ඉන්න සමහරට වැඩිපුර ෆෝන් එක පාවිච්චි කරන. ටීවී එකට වැඩිපුර කාලය යොදවන. ඊතර අම්මට තාත්තට අකීකරුවන්. ඒ වාගේ දේවල් මිතුරු හමු එකතු වෙලා කතා කරනවා. මේ තියෙන්නේ ජංගම ගොදුරු පොත. මේකෙත් ඒ වගේ දරුවෝ මොන මොන දේවල් වලට ගොදුරු වෙලා ඉන්නවද කියලා මෙතන විශේෂ මාතෘකා ටිකක් දාලා තිනවා. ඊට පස්සේ දරුවන්ට පුළුවන් එයාලා මොනවාට ගොදුරු වෙලා ඉන්නවද ඒ වගේ මයින් වෙනවද ඒ වගේ යෝජනා මේ පොතේ ලියන්න පුළුවන්. ඒ වගේ මේ දැන් අපේ මේ ගමේ විශේෂම අපේ ගම් වල තියෙන දෙයක් තමයි ෆෝන් පාවිච්චි කරන එක. මේ තියෙන ෆෝන් කාඩ් වල දාන ගමෙන් යන සල්ලි. මේ අපි ප්‍රස්තාර ගත කරලා තියෙන්නේ. ඒ වගේ මෙතන වැඩ ගොඩාක් තියෙනවා මම හිතන්නේ දෙන්නන්ට ගියොත් අපිට දවස් ගානක් විතර ඕන වෙයි.
සුදි මම හිතන්නේ අපිට කාට හරි වුණා නම් මේ තේ විවේකයේදී අපේ මේ කණ්ඩායමෙන් ඒ ගැන වැඩි විස්තර දැනගන්න පුළුවන්. ඕමි සුදි මේ මදවචී ඉඳලා ඇවිල්ලා
So I will just briefly describe how I understood it and how I am using it, because I know like still some of these concepts are difficult for us to convert into our settings as people who are practicing medicine. So let's see how we can tackle this thing. So I'm focusing on community medicine and public health stream, so to see what kind of research we are doing in the health ministry and all these health institutions in our country. Most of the time we can say the research we are doing could be categorized as evaluations, audits and monitoring, and then we are doing implementation things and we are doing research on that, and then clinical trials and basically epidemiological research we are doing a lot. So the difference that I see with Kiel and in our setup is that in Kiel, Kiel University, the Primary Healthcare Institute, they are specializing in a particular area, so musculoskeletal disorders. So they are doing research in musculoskeletal disorders. But when it comes to our setting, we are doing research in different things, in different areas. Some of the research we are doing in maternal and child health, some of the research we are doing on family planning. So the public or the patients that we are using differ quite a lot in different settings. So I was having the problem whether it is possible for us to have a one group of people, as what Kiel do. They have RUG members, a group of people who are having musculoskeletal disorders who are involved in their research throughout. So in that particular place they are doing about 100 or 150 research per year. So all these research get those RUG members involved for the PPIE aspect. So how can we do that in our setting was a little bit of a problem in my mind. How can we do this? So but at the end, when we think, so why do we all conduct all these research from our health ministry and all these our clinical units and all these things? Why do we conduct this research? It is for the benefit of the patient. No, ultimately, we have to give some improvement for the patient's life or the public's life. So, but if we don't get them involved, sometimes we get very bizarre kind of experiences from the research that we conduct without getting people involved. So therefore we have to get them involved. But how is the problem? There's no question about getting people involved. But my problem was how to get them involved. So for that, one thing we have to change the way we think, like from the way we see ourselves as medical professionals, from this paternalism, we have moved a little bit to the patient-centered care, and now we have to move for the partnership of care. The world is changing. We also have to change because our patients are also not the same patients that we had all these years back. They are also improving. So it is very easy for us to get them into the partnership and collaborate with them and provide service which is beneficial for us as well as for the patients. So this patient could be in different setup, could be, for example, if we are doing an implementation research, if the group of people we are going to implement this on are public health midwives, then of course we can get them involved in our research design and talk with them and work with them as a group. Patients doesn't have to be patients all the time. Depending on the type of the research, I thought we can change the people who we get involved. For example, now as I said earlier, we are doing evaluations, monitoring, those kind of research also we are doing. So if we can get people who are under that process, like for example public health midwife or MOH or a GP or whoever the people, into that research design and keep on continuing with that, that's also I think a way of PPIE. So of course, this is the concept now, with or by members of the public rather than to about for them. What we normally do is we are doing research to the public, about the public, for them. But we have to now with them or by them. That's what I think earlier they have explained you very beautifully, the health promotion team, how they have done it with them and by them. So that's the place where we can go, where we have to go. So in the Sri Lankan context, as I said, our research culture is a little bit different and we have a lot of bureaucracy and all these issues. And our culture, Sri Lankan culture also. Sometimes, though we want to get our patients and public involved, sometimes we have to empower them and get them into a level so that they speak with us. They give their honest opinion. Because what normally happens is we are so much used to lecture them and give our inputs to them, they have become passive listeners. So we have to change that culture also to get them actually involved in our research. So I'll share with you one of the experiences that we have done in Gaul district. I was the consultant community physician looking after maternal and child health care in Gaul district, and we had to develop a committee to think about maternal mental health, because in the 2018 year, out of 7 maternal deaths we had in that year, 4 were due to suicide. So there was a suggestion from the experts, develop a committee and do some research on maternal mental health and try to embed maternal mental health component into the MCH care package. So we had to develop a committee consisting of consultant obstetricians, psychiatrists and the community physicians, MOH, PHM and all these categories. So at that we suggested, okay, why don't we get 1, 2 or 3 people who have experienced postpartum depression, or who, we had a lot of like near-miss cases who were going to harm themselves but who were saved by the system with the intervention. So we thought, why can't we get few of them involved in this committee and get their inputs from the beginning, how we are going to plan this, how we are going to do research and what are the most important things that we have to address in this community, and the things that we don't see as clinicians, how they experience all these services we provided, what will happen if we have a maternal mental health clinic, will they go to that? There are so many things that we can get ideas from them. But actually when we try to do that, there were a lot of resistance. So there were sayings, why do we have to get them, would they understand what we are talking? So there are a lot of problems. So what I want to tell you is that when you try to do this as researchers or as doctors in your institution, there will be a resistance because people don't know about this concept. So one of the most important thing is to talk with them and do at least whatever you can. You may not be able to start a formal RUG group or formal PPIE group and follow them throughout, but at least if you can get them involved in small steps, at least for one thing and the second thing and then third thing, then we can have a momentum and later on this will roll on. The people will understand what we are talking about. And so ultimately we got them involved, but only for about 2 meetings, and still it is going on because we had only 2 meetings. But they provide very valuable inputs. But the issue is, when all these consultants and obstetricians and all these people are in our culture, they don't talk much with them. When they are in the group, they don't talk much. So therefore we have to, I mean, because we use a lot of medical jargon, all these words, so we have to educate the people in our team to talk in lay terms and come into that their level also and talk in a level so that everybody can understand and everybody can contribute rather than us being the doctors and the professionals in that room. So it's a bit difficult. But I think it is very much possible, very much possible, very much possible. Sometimes we do this without knowing also as PPIE, we do this, we go to community, get some inputs and do certain things, but we don't do the whole process. We don't get them in all at the initial stage and then the research conducting stage and then how when analyzing the results and discussing all these stages, we do not get them involved usually. But we can get their inputs. We can always get their inputs from at each of these stages. And also, PPIE, I think it may promote research also. Because we are doing something useful for the people and they are also interested and they also actively participated. Now, as I said earlier that
the people are not only the lay people, but if we are thinking about some monitoring and evaluation research for the doctors and the staff, we can get them involved also. There is another example that is also from Gaul. We wanted to have sort of a new program running on for preconception care, where the medical officers of health has to do some additional work. They have to go and collect the information and write in another book and do something additional. So rather than us providing it as a thing that you have to do, we got them involved in the discussions and discussed with them, how would you like to do this and would you think this will benefit if we do it in this way. So that also was very successful because they got involved in the planning process. They were continuing it in the implementation process as well. Rather than with the power, if you are saying you have to do this, if you get them involved, they take it as something that belongs to them and they continue with that. So as a person who's in policy and system and program planning, I think PPIE is not limited only for research. For our programs, whatever we do a lot of programs in the country, maternal and child health or whatever, well women and all these programs, we get a lot of budgets for the programs and we plan the program, we plan the monitoring and evaluation process, and then we have to give the results, everything. We can have the PPIE component, not only for the research. For that also, from the beginning, we can get the people involved. We can have a group and get them involved throughout the program, which are going for about 4 to 5 years. A particular program might go for about 4 to 5 years. So each stage, we can get them involved. That's why I say can be used in program planning and implementation. Now saying that, it is not that we should do that, but I think we'll have to do this in future because now the whole world is moving towards that direction. Now we as a country has promised to deliver the sustainable development goals in 2030. So what they monitor the output is through the results, not from how many workshops we have done, how many meetings we have conducted. They wanted to see the results, and results are the change in behavior of people or some kind of a real change they want to see. So they are asking evidence from us, and we have to measure that change also. So in that process, what they say, the results-based management, we have to get the people involved, otherwise there's no way for us to measure the change. So they say even small evaluations sometimes are shown as results if it has done some change in people's behavior. So as the world is also moving into that direction, from monitoring process indicators to the results-based indicators, it is a must that we have to get these patient and public involved in each step of our research or either programs. And another important part of this PPIE, that according to my understanding, when we get people involved, we can catch the aspects that we normally miss, especially the vulnerable and underprivileged people. So whenever we plan programs and research, we normally don't think about them. But if we have a sufficient group of people to discuss these problems and get into their shoes and see from their aspects, we might be able to see how these vulnerable and underprivileged people are suffering more in whatever we do in our programs and plan. So that is also is one good thing I see as incorporating PPIE in whatever we do in the research and the programs. So that is promote inclusion. So, how to embed this? Raising awareness of the importance of PPIE, we have to talk about it. Can make it mandatory for research proposals grants? Yes, it is possible. International collaboration to strengthen the existing knowledge, exchange experience, and address barriers to effective use. So that's what we are doing now. We are raising awareness, we are getting the international collaboration, we are talking with the people who have already done that, so we can do the same thing in your own practice as well. So can we ask PGIM to make PPIE a requirement in research? Well, there will be a resistance, but it is possible and it will benefit both the student as well as the country. And ethical committees, can we ask them PPIE a requirement for ethical approval? Yes, that is also possible, and we should slowly move to that direction.
health ministry, we are getting a lot of proposals for the ETNR. Lot of research proposals from the hospitals, wards and everywhere, yes, we can get. And NHSL prof units can have a patient team established based on disease. So I saw that NHSL and all these tertiary care hospital prof units where they do conduct a lot of research in a particular subject area. May it be gastroenterology or like diabetes or chronic renal disease, there are a lot of research going on. So in that places, they can have a PPI group like in Kiel, like a special group who are having the disease. So many researchers are going on. They can have that group, so everybody can get them involved in their research. That is possible in these places. So need to create a system to create a PPI team for chronic health conditions. That's what I just talked about. So if we have a system in our wards where we have like chronic diseases, a group of people where we can always get their inputs and get them in the planning, implementation and the results, every phase of the research, that is possible for us to do if you think about it. And even for the long-term projects, we can develop PPI teams. The projects conducted by the health ministry, which are going for about 3 to 4 years, we can have a PPI team from the beginning to the end of the project and get their inputs. So that's how I feel that we can get PPIE incorporated in our system. I think there should be many more creative ideas. There should be many other ways that you might think how we can do it, because if you really want to do it, you can do it. And it will really benefit for the people and for yourself as well. Because ultimately what we try to do is to improve the lives of the people. So there is, our results would be much more pragmatic and user-friendly for the public, rather than us deciding everything and ultimately coming out with something which is not usable, and all these our theses are kept in piles in different places, locked, and nobody's using them. So what we have to change from that. Now what I have seen in Kiel also, even for the clinical trials, now they are saying you do the experiments in all these controlled environments, and when you go to the patient-doctor interface, all these high-proven with lot of p-values, all these highly statistical qualified interventions doesn't work at the patient-public interface. So the reason is we haven't got their inputs. We haven't thought how patients would take this. We haven't thought what are the other small things that are very much important for them, which we don't see as clinicians. So that's what I have to say. Thank you very much.
Into our research in order to improve our research high quality, valuable, impactful knowledge. we have already discussed, rather than just making them participate in our research, it's important to involve them in our research. Involvement means that patient and the public working in a partnership with the researcher. And we will involve them in different stages of the research cycle. That means in the planning stage and designing, managing the research and evaluating the research, as well as at the end we have to disseminate our findings. So we can involve these people in all these stages in our research. And here the involvement means we are keeping them, we are taking their perspectives, their point of views, their insights, their ideas into as the heart of the research, and we will take them into, we have to take them into decision making process of the research, right? So here in the research cycle, we can include the PPIE can be present in each and every stage, and it stresses where they add the value to the research. If you involve in insights of people in each and every stage, you will be able to get more in your research. So most of, as we already discussed, most of the researchers are done with either government funding or grant funding. So they are, the researcher has an ethical obligation to do a research which is very much beneficial to the patient or public. So rather than doing a research according to our own interest, we have to take their ideas and shape it into a very useful thing. And also, they can tell us what are the best methods to approach this particular issue, and also they can tell us what are the methods we can use, and also they will be the best source to tell us how to recruit participants, what are the methods we should use. So they can be incorporated in study, selecting the, finalizing the study design, and also definitely with the developing research materials. In the very beginning stage, in the planning stage, we can involve them in developing materials, revising materials, how to make these materials in a more, in a way everyone can understand. So, and also, definitely they can be, act as a co-applicants for the research grant. Because, let me give you an example. The autism research planned by IRD included lay members as co-applicants because of their valuable contribution in developing the concept. So, and they can be members of the research team. And also, when we are implementing the research process, it is very important to keep them in the advisory committee of the research, because don't know, there may be incidents like things are not going as we planned. So they are, rather than more than the ideas which are coming to our mind, people will be able to provide you very good solutions for those things. So they will be troubleshoot in a better way. And also they can be involved in data collection. Research suggests that they can be contribute more when the research is qualitative, and also they can build up a very good relationship between the interviewer and the interviewee, and they can do qualitative kind of data collection, and they can make a better communication between those two. So that means they will be able to provide us rich data, and also taking their perspectives in our analysis will be very useful, because only then we can get what these results mean to people and patients, what are the key messages from these findings we should take for further implication. program, and also they can be involved in dissemination of the findings. That means, as what the committee members did here, they can disseminate the findings of the research. They can easily do public events, and also they can inform others as well about the research findings. And also, I have to tell you that it is very important to involve patient and public in the very early stage of the research process. Involving people in the planning stage is very crucial, and that's the most important thing. We have to involve them in very early stage. So, here, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to discuss about the impact of PPIE research. Here, I'm going to summarize the findings of the research conducted by Dr. Stephen Backman, who is a pioneer in PPIE in the UK. He did the research with other colleagues and also with the community members. What is the impact of PPIE? So, he found these are the impacts of PPIE, so I will summarize them here. So, if we include a PPIE component in our research, so we will be able to address the most important issues, right? And also, it will help us to improve the quality of the research, and it will help us to ensure that we use money for in an effective way. And also, it will increase the relevancy of the paper, research, and also the outcomes will be more useful rather than just doing what we're going to do. And also it will help for further implications, and it will ensure that research is beneficial to the patient groups, and it will increase the validity of the research, as well as it will improve the follow-up rates. Here, these are the impacts on researcher. Having a PPIE group is definitely a motivation factor for the researcher, because patient and public, they are very much keen about the results of this research, and also they will bring enthusiasm to the research, and also there will be a supportive group to the researcher, and also researcher will be able to gain the better understanding of the condition of interest. Because if you are going to do a research on depression, you may or you may not have experienced it in your life. So always, it's always useful to get their perspectives in your research. And also it will help him to build up the trust between the researcher and the participants. And also it will reduce the burden of the researcher and make his life easier as well. And here, these are the benefits for the participants. So it will definitely increase the understanding and knowledge of their own condition, and also it will increase the awareness of treatment options and how to access services, and it will increase their understanding about the research and research methodologies, and also it will help them to improve their skills as well. For example, public speaking or IT skills even. And also, it has a positive emotional impact on them, because they feel that they are doing something which will be very useful. So here, I have included several slides which will give you a kind of understanding how we can involve people in research process. This is a study conducted in Kalaniduruvada Education Zone. This is about bullying among early adolescents in Sri Lanka, and this study included a prevalence study as well as a health promotion intervention. So in this study, students from the school was involved very much at the very beginning stage to develop the intervention as well. So here you can see how children are initially engaged with the research. They were very enthusiastic about the research. And also here you can see how they involved in planning of the research. Here they are for the intervention, they are involved in identifying determinants and prioritizing them, and also they plan activities which they should address in order to change the determinants. So here they devise indicators to monitor the progress, and they are also involved in developing the tools for the intervention. So that's the end of the presentation. And especially thanking these people, I'd like to thank you as well. Thank you very much.
Now we are in the real business end of this session. The idea is to see what will you take away from this 2.5 hours of exposure. I'm supposed to summarize at the end, but I want to summarize now. And then leave it for you to use that also. Use the group discussion also to try to get things into your head as to what you might, how you might use this information. So, we have thoughts of, A, if people have already done this kind of activity, can I know if anybody has done this? Otherwise, we are going to change this subject. This was the original group work. But if nobody has done PPIE activity, we have a different set of group works. Can people raise their hands if they have already done PPIE work? Then we put another step. Finish. We will have 4 subjects that each group will take up. This is the idea. I'll translate Kanwani. This is the idea. Each group will take up one of these 4 subjects, and we will give things. We will give you the option of selecting which of these 4 subjects you want to discuss. And then we see how can we use the information we got today. Very short discussion. එපසේ අපි ආයතනය කර මෙල්ල බලන මොකක්ද අපිට ගන්න පුළුවන් අරගෙන යන්න පුළුවන් ප්‍රයෝජනවත් දේ හැමෝටම do your research or just with your researcher or housewife from Medavach. So everybody must take something away either personally or in their profession, but ඒ අදහසින් තමයි මේක ගන්න, because we will take these subjects and then share in the discussion what each group presents. So the group discussion will last 5 or 10 minutes, then we will have a round of presentations and another 5 minutes, and we will still end before 12:40. Can each group, if you are too big, break it into 2 and decide which of these, I will change the subject you check if everybody chooses the same subject. Hari? බලෙන් මම මාරු කරයි හැමෝම එකම ගෲප් එකක එකම මාතෘකාව ගත්තා. නමුත් දැනට නිකන් අපි කැමති මේක කියලා විනාඩියෙන් තීන්දුව කරන්න පුළුවන් ද මේ හැම ගෲප් එකේම මේ 4න් එකක්. ඒක තුල අපි අනිත් ඉතුරු ටික ඔක්කොම ඇතුළත් කරා. බට් මේ සබ්ජෙක්ට් එකක් තෝරන්න. හරි. හරි. මෙතන ඕන කරන්නේ we are giving you just 10 minutes at the start. හරි? 10 minutes to decide මොකද්ද මේ අපි ගත්තේ අද? Patient public involvement. ඒ කියන්නේ අපිට තිබුණා නම් සිස්ටම් එක රිසර්ච් වලට ආවම රිසර්ච් වලින් නෝ කරනවා. හරිද? මුන් කර කර මේ ඇයට දෙනවා. මෙතන ඉන්න ප්‍රශ්න අපිට අරගෙන යනවා. හරි? එක්ක දෙයයි කරනවා. අනිත් මේකේ අපි ඔක්කොම ඉන්නේ මෙතන. අරන් තමයි රිසර්ච් කරනවා. ඉන්ටර්වෙන්ෂන් උත් එහෙම. මේක මෙහෙම බෑ කියන එක තමයි ඕන. හරිම විදිහ මේ කණෙක් ඇත්තට. හරිද? ඒ ඉන්නවා. හරිම විදිහ මේක අනිත් ඇත්තට. right? අපි තමයි තීන්දුව කරන්න ඕන රිසර්ච් එක මොකක්ද? හරි?
ඇහෙනවද ගංගා? එක්වාට හරි. ඔක්කොම ඔක්කොමලා they are also citizens. They are also human beings. Or the public. අපි මෙතන ඉන්නේ ඒ ඇටිටියුඩ් එක අපි කොහොමද රෝපණය කරන්නේ ඉන්ද පබ්ලික් එන්ටර්ප්‍රයිස් ඉන්ද ක්ලිනිකල් එන්ටර්ප්‍රයිස් in the community well-being enterprise and also in the research enterprise. ඒක තමයි බලන්න. හරිද? ඒකට මෙන්න මෙහෙම එකක් කියනවා. මුලක් හරි උදාහරණයක් අරගෙන හිතනවා to make the public and patients and public in මහජනයාට සතු කරන්න මේ වැඩේ to make people own this enterprise. When I try to do this, you will find lots of obstacles. මේක මේ කාමරේ ඉඳන් අපිට මරු. නමුත් කරන්න කියන්නේ බෑ. හරි? clinical එකේ දොස්තර මම කියමු. මගේ patient මගේ ප්‍රශ්න ඇහුවාම ડોક્ટર මේ බෙහෙතද හොඳ අර අලුත් අය කියනවනේ මේකයි කියලා අපේ ගමේ. මම නම් එහෙම දොස්තර කෙනෙක් නෙමෙයි. නමුත් ඇත්තම මිනිස්සු අහන්නෙත් නෑ. In clinical work also, we decide, others comply. හරියක තමයි මේකට යකෝ බේත ඕනද කියලා. To improve depression, just getting people to walk around and exercise and move and be active and be in the sun and have good daylight and eat better is quite effective. Right? Anti-diabetic pethi wage innen adu wenawa awashya. Harida? Pressure ekata beeta dan innen awashya adu pramana. Wage check karana. Dan ekata videwa apita ganna naha dossarala ekka api me PPIE kiyana magula naththam. Ewat mahajanayata ho apita tiyena idea naththa. So the first thing to think about is in whatever condition that you chose. Clinical, samaje, whatever. We don't have the habit or the culture that professionals and others are equals or actually should be the servants of the public. Unmake itself. Unmake karaniya. මම දැන් හෙට ඉඳන් මේක කරනවා කියලා හිතාගෙන කිව්වොත් in my personal life මොනවද අපිට මේකට තියෙන බාධක? කරන එකට හරවගෙන යන්න අංචු මාත්‍රිකව. So consider that. What are the obstacles, resistance, blocks? දැන් මම උදාහරණයක් කිව්වා. මම දොස්තර නම් මගේ private practice එකේ ඉන්න රෝගීන් එක්ක රෝගීන්ට ඒ බලය පාවිච්චි කරන්න බෑ මාත්. මම ඉදිරියට දෙන්නේ. කමිටි හෙල්ත් බජට් එහෙම. සෞඛ්‍ය සේවා නිලධාරිනියට වඩා ඉහළින් ඉන්න බෑ මහජනට. හෝ PHIට වඩා හෝ ඉමෝයිට වඩා. කොහොමද? ඉස්කෝලේ ළමයි ටික එක්කව වෙලා අම්මල රාතලගේ බර මැන්න ඉස්කෝලේ. ඒ ඒරියාගේ අඩු වුණා පුදුම විදිහට මඩවච්චේ නෙමෙයි. හරි. ප්‍රෙෂර් අඩු වුණා ඩයබටිස් අඩු වුණා අම්මලගේ බර හරි පැත්තට ගියා ළමයිගේ ලකුණු වැඩි වුණා. එහෙනම් වෛද්‍යවරයෙක් ඇවිල්ලා මං කියන්නේ කොහෙද කියලා. ඇවිල්ලා MOH එකෙන් දෙන්න කියලා බලලා. මොකද MOH එකෙන් ආවේ මේ 5 years. කවුද මේ ළමයින්ට කියන්නේ ප්‍රෙෂර් බලන්න? අර ඔටෝමැටික් ගැජට් එක. මේක නවත්තන්න කියන වහම. අන්න ඒව තමයි මේ වැඩේ තියෙන බාධක. empower people කියන්නේ empower නෙමෙයි කරන්න ඕනේ disempower කරන එක නවත්තන්න. අපි තමයි අයිතිකාරයෝ. මට තමයි මේ apparatus එක තේරෙන්නේ. ඒක ඉස්සෙල්ලා හිතන්න. Think of the setting and then see what obstacles do we encounter in our own heads. අපේ මේ and in the public among our peers and society. කොහොමද මේ විදිහට පොඩ්ඩක් හෝ අපි පිළියමක් හදා ගන්න කියන එක තීන්දුව කරගෙන ගියොත් අද දවසට වැඩිත් එක්ක මේක ඇත්තටම රෝපණය කරන්නේ කොහොමද මං හිතන ක්ලිනික් එක මං හිතන ප්‍රජාව මං හිතන රිසර්ච් ඉන්ස්ටිටියුෂන් අදට වඩා හොඳයි දැන් IRD එකේ ඕනේ IRD එකේ කොහොමද තියෙන්නේ වෙනද ඒක තීන්දුව කරන්න අංශු මාත්‍රික හෝ වැඩක් අරගෙන යන්න එතකොට ලෝකෙ පෙරලන්න පුළුවන් Now start. You have 10 minutes to do, change the world. Change the world in 10 minutes. Okay.
who would like to, shall we start with the difficult subject? Ms. Rachni. Who is the spokesperson? Right. I will translate into Sinhala or Tamil if you can't understand your English.
Thank you, sir. My topic is improve research and its publications. Research is, if we move to the word research, it's finding a new knowledge. We will be based on a existing knowledge and we'll be...
We have given you only 1.5 minutes to finish everything.
Thank you, sir. So, to find a new knowledge, we need ideas from public and from patients. So the obstacles we have found out is, the first thing is the attitude of the researcher. As doctors or researchers, sometimes we have some sort of ego, so attitudes that we know everything. Just because of that, we don't get the proper knowledge what we intend to gain from patients. So to come out of this obstacle, we have some suggestions like, we can informally talk to colleagues and we can talk about the ways how we can get involved patients in a new way. And also in hospital, in the hospital settings, we have barriers like administrative obstructions. To come out of it, we propose we can have some sort of gathering, like awareness programs for public and patient. So in that case, patients who are receiving treatments from us and who will be our research participants will be involving to the research with an awareness of what they are going to face. So in that case, we can have some sort of gathering. The other obstacle we have, there is no enough governance or policy on patients' involvement, so government should take necessary actions for it. Thank you, sir.
Excellent. So, shall we say, we will all agree, right? We will all agree this thing about researchers think apitamai danne and they don't involve patients. And the suggestion is also very practical. We will disseminate this idea among doctors. Yako, patients and public are pretty good researchers. Apiya workshop pegata. People are changing hypothesis ekak danawa dala test karanawa api research kara we do research. We are stuck with the protocol. We can't change it. But the lady on the video said we changed our whole measurement system because we are getting results that are not likely. Then we questioned our methods of measurement. Then we re-evaluated our measurement. Now, we are going to keep it there. Now, we are going to keep it there. මේ මහ ලොකු රිසර්ච් ඩිග්‍රී අරගෙන ඉන්න එකට වඩා හොඳට යමේම මනුස්සයන්ට දුන්නම රිසර්ච් එක කරනවා උන්ට වඩා හොඳට. ඒක අපි දොස්තරලා ඔක්කොමලට කියමු. So that's a practical step that they are doing and they will tell other people. And don't forget all of us. අද ඉඳන් මේ වැඩේ කරනවා. වඩ කරයි කියලා තේරෙන්නේ. Anyone now wants to do the business?
Thank you, sir, for giving this opportunity. Yes, my topic is promoting community health. Actually, we have identified the obstacles as the prejudice of the professionals and knowledge gap, the language barriers, and the myths and beliefs of the rural areas, and the thinking patterns, lifestyle patterns, and the religious cultural barriers, inability to forward in the community, not exposing their reality. Actually, we suggest to overcome these obstacles, we should have changed the attitudes in the case of this. We should conduct the advocacy programs and practice them how to behave in the society. And we should reduce the gap between that gaps you have shown this. The gap is we should go to the grassroots level of that community, and we should be friendly with that community, not only the community, but also the environment also. I suggest the professionalism is the main barrier, and we should more practice and be healthy, sorry, be friendly with that community. Thank you very much, sir.
Brilliant. Again, also on time. Right? I have a suggestion. We are going to give this back to you now for another 2 minutes of discussion after listening to everybody. Do programs and that's too big. How do we give them program? I want a different suggestion. Each of us can do things in our own life, like they said, right? They said, we talk to the people that we meet. Ekedi, oage list ekak dan digawadi. Hariyada? Ekko api kiyanawa, we will get people to discuss these issues. Karala. Practically, after you listen to everybody, now don't start discussing this now, right? Eddinada jeevithaye mata puluwan ehema kiyanne program ekak karanna puluwan. But day-to-day life, something that I'm going to do, that is how this health promotion business works. Api inne ne, da ogalange aapu presentation wala rahasa mokadda? Api inne ne maha eka wenaka. Heta karanna puluwan podi eka karanawa. Eka balanawa, eke pragatiya taksiru karanawa. So now change and include that element also, but after listening to everybody else.
Well, thank you. And our categories improve. improve some aspect of the society. So we choose teachers in a school. And we chose that teaching style should be changed. For an example,
what this group chose, meegalu gatta teenduwa, was group number 4, the subject number 4, samaje mokak hari wenas karanna one kiyala. Hari sahayaka research karala manina. And the subject they chose was teachers' attitudes to children. Ekena wenas karanna yanne. Hari, thank you.
So that teachers' attitudes towards their children and teaching style, and we get an example and teachers trying, like an environmental study teaching teacher, she wants to take their children to outdoor studies, not teaching in the classroom, and she is taking the students outdoor, and there are so many problems facing her, like peer teachers would be jealous about the teacher, that the children may be very happy about the environment and they get a freedom, and the security problems like insect bites, and some children will climb trees and like that issues, and discipline problems, and the sometimes at urban areas no outdoor space, and parents issues, a parent might not like this teaching style, and these are the problems. We have to empower the children, and while doing this study, changing the teaching style, we can evaluate the teacher by asking questions from the children, and if they are if they are happy with the teaching style, then I think the teacher is success, and it's a good way to evaluate the teacher's attitude.
Meka tamai community ekek process ek hari
මනුස්සයෝ එකතු වෙලා වාඩි වෙලා තීන්දු කරනකොට කෝටියක් අදහස් වෙනවා. සහ ඔගොල්ලෝ ඉස්සෙල්ලම කියපේක තමයි හරියම කියන මට හිතෙනවා. One teacher says අපි මේ දැන් මේ ස්වභාව දහම හරි මොකක් හරි එකක් උගන්වන්න යනවා පන්ති කාමරේ නෙවෙයි. Let's go out and do it. The children like it. And they are happy. And they are learning fast. But they, you remember what they said, is the first obstacle. Isselam mokad megulu kiwe meka karanna giyot thiyena badake. And etana school inna nahuruma teacher mekata kamena. Ekko modama, ekko rigidma. එයා එයාගේ එකටම හරවන්න ඕනේ මේ ළමයි මේ පන්තියේ හොඳට කරන කොට සම්පූර්ණ එයාට අප්සෙට්. දැන් ඕලඟ ඊළඟ වටේකුත් අපි දෙනවා වෙලාවක් කතා කරන්න. මේ කල්චර් එක ගුරුවරු අතරේ තියෙන කල්චර් එක. දොස්තරලගේ කල්චර් එක හිතන්නකො දවිදෙනින් වැඩි ડોක්ටර්ස්. OBD එකෙන් තේ වෙලාවක් කියලා එනවා. ලිදු බලවල ඉඳලා එක්කෙනෙක් යනවා රේමෝට. හරි. තව කෙනෙක් ඉන්නවා ලෙඩු ඒ ලෙඩ ඉවර කරලා. මේ බීලත් එයා ආපහු ඉක්මන්නේ නැහැ. එයා මේ patient interaction වැඩිත් ආසාවෙන් කරනවා. නමුත් එතන ඉන්නවා තව දොස්තර කෙනෙක්. ඒක අනිත් පැත්ත. එයා මේක නවත්තනවා. හරි හරි හරි. අර කියලා. ඒක අනිත් දාර දැල ගන්නවා. priority දෙන්න එපා රෝගීන්ගේ වැඩේට. Just like teachers. The worst, weakest, least interested person in that group stops the others doing something joyful. They are at the end of it. They are asana minisu satutin innawa eka karanne yata ekata inna beri. Ekata arawa kanna. Teachers lage wediye wageema dossara lathana. Me culture ekak hadanne kohomada kiyala ilanga wate ganna but after listening to everybody you may not have time today to discuss that, but then we'll meet at home.
Thanks to be. අපි මෙතනදී තොරගත්තේ අංක දෙක මේ curative service වෙත. මේදී අපිට අවශ්‍ය වෙන්නේ අනවශ්‍ය ප්‍රතිකාර ඖෂධ ලබා ගැනීම සහ වෛද්‍යවරයාට එන රෝගී සංඛ්‍යාව අවම කරන මෙඩිකල් සෙන්ටරකට එන මේ රෝගී සංඛ්‍යාව අඩු කර ගැනීම. එතනදී සරල දෙයකින් අපිට ප්‍රතිකාර කිරීම සහ රෝගියාගෙන් අහනවා මොකද්ද ඇයි ඔයාලා මෙතනට ආවේ. එතකොට ඒගොල්ලෝ මොකක් ප්‍රතිකාරයක් ගන්න කියලා ප්‍රතිකාරයක් ගත්තහම දැන් ඔයා මොකද ලබපු දියුණුව මේ ප්‍රතිකාරේ අඩු කරී ගැනීමට මොකද කරේ. එතකොට ඒක ඔබට කොච්චර දුරකට ශරීරයකට යහපත් වුණාද. එතකොට එහෙමනම් ඒගොල්ලෝ යොදාගෙනම අපිට පුළුවන් සමාජයට ඒ පණිවිඩය ගෙනියන්නේ අනිකුත් වෙන මේ රෝගීට. එතන සරල උදාහරණයක් වශයෙන් ගත්තාම උණ ගත්තාම උණ හැදීගෙන ඉන්නකොට සමහර අය කරන මේක මේ වෛරස් නිසා එන උණ. එතකොට මේ වෛරස් නිසා එන උණට අන්න කන්න ඕනේ ගොඩක් කියලා. එතකොට අය මට දැන් තියෙන අත්දැකීමත් එක්ක ගත්තාම දැන් රෑ ආහාර වේල නැතුව සරල ආහාර වේලක් ගත්තාම ඒ උණ පහසුවෙන් සුව කරගන්න පුළුවන්. ඒ ඉන්නේ අපි සරල ප්‍රතිකාරය. ඒ කියන්නේ කොත්තමල්ලි වලින් කරගන්න පුළුවන් දේට ලොකු බෙහෙත්යක් ගන්න ඕනේ නැහැ කියන එක තමයි තියෙන්නේ. එතනදී දැන් අපි දැන් බුදුහාමුදුරන්ගේ ගත්තාම බුදුහාමුදුර සරල පරීක්ෂණයක් කරලා තියෙනවානේ සිවුරු හතක් දාගෙන ඉවරලා එතනදී මොකක්ද මේක සීතල බලක් ගන්න අවශ්‍ය කරන ප්‍රමාණය කියලා සිවුරු ප්‍රමාණය කියලා ඒකනේ දුන්නේ විනීති මේක පාවිච්චි කරන්නේ කියලා. ඒ වගේ තමයි මෙතනදී අපි සරල දෙයින් කොහොමද සමාජයට සමාජයත් එක්කම මේක ගෙනියන්නේ.
Look at how wonderful these ideas are. That have come up. Eka tamai me patient, public involvement, engagement ke ani me aptamai patient and public ke gani. Right? And we are now addressing the medical profession. And this, sorry, this group's interest, or maybe only yours, හරි එයා බලෙන් දැම්ම දෙයගේ අම්ම කියන හරි පැනලා ගත්තනේ මාතිවා හරි this group subject is අනවශ්‍ය බේත් how do we reduce unnecessary prescriptions in medical practice so for the next round can you think about unnecessary prescriptions in private medical practice saha resistance ekak hatiyata ganna public patient ekek ledduma thamai meka prescribe karawa ayyo me me vitamin c pettai viriten nedunne eka thamai yona ara unai palawen dalas karanawa patient involvement ekak ganna patient la thamai apita kiyala ekek bahumuta prescribe karawanne dostarla dekata panna ganawa ඒක ඇඩ්‍රස් කරන හැටි ගන්න patient demand එකත් හදලා දෙන්න
so we chose the fourth topic to improve aspects of community our target was elderly population how we integrate them into society so we want to organize a forum to so for them to share their knowledge with the younger people since they're experts with experience they can retain some of their respect and dignity while sharing their experience with the younger population also we can hold workshops on how to use technology to improve connectivity and to decrease their phobia for learning new things and therefore using that to become part of society obstacles would be like Sri Lankan society and culture and people won't be able to understand or increase the connection between the older people and younger generations. And for government involvement is distribution of public funds towards that cause. Also recognition of mental health problems and stigma in Sri Lanka. And since they tend to ignore what they say and it's not a modern thing.
So what did you mean? All right, again for you all also, instead of waiting for that major workshop type thing, my request is how do you do this day to day, right? Like we said today, then translate that from the larger workshop and campaigning and big thing to what can I do day to day, right? In another minute.
So the topic we chose is improving one aspect of the society by influencing the smokers to stop and reduce smoking with the help of their own children. So the plan is to select a village where there is a high abundance of smokers and then the research team would be a collective group of people comprising of the children, the family members, the smokers themselves, and so all the different areas of people from
and the smokers themselves talk. Then make a public එක තමයි smokers ලා. And I'm very happy that you say. The smokers themselves, again, prajavaka dupanaya karana ayawa eken godda liha ganna ekko adu karaganna ekko eken athara paaganna ekko ara mosaliyo tika karan unwa rawatthana hati unta therila unta painna smokers themselves tamai subjects patient and public involvement in research katam ne subject is the smoker super eka gana vitarak kiyagena yanne den smokers lagin ma ogulu dakina role ek o yojana
so we try to influence the smokers with the help of their children so what we can do is we can start from the homes with themselves so maybe the children directly going to their fathers and asking about why do you smoke and everything will not be successful. So what can be done is maybe the child can paint a picture of something or maybe hang a drawing in the home itself and display so that the father can see from time to time. So maybe he gets the idea.
Do the research now. Research ekak meke sambandhay ne. If the children start doing the research, ekeni okalu karanne. Ewa panerakan chat dan manala lamai research ekak karanna gatta. Eka lamayek kiyenawa mama me gamema wiyadan tika garan hada. Tawa lamayek kiyenawa mama me research me gamema hama lamai hama taattatama wadiyema pona taatta hoyaga. ඒකනේ මොඩම සාර. තවලමෙක් කියනවා මේ කඩේ මුදලාලි අපිට ෆෝන් එක වළක්වනවා CTC එකට බොක්ක නොදී මහජනයගේ පැත්තට හරවන්න ගන්න. දැන් මොනවද ඉන්ඩිකේටර්ස් මුදලාලිගේ බොක්ක CTC පැත්තද මහජනය පැත්තද? මිනිස්සු හදනවා ඉන්ඩිකේටර්ස්. හරි. ඕකේ.
Question that we chose is the over usage of mobile phones among the youngsters. For this problem, we thought to choose some youngsters aged between 15 to 24 so that we can give them a Q&A session first and asking what are the things that they gain from mobile phones, so that main things that they would say, we guess that would say is playing games, and mostly that she said boys use mobile phones to attract girlfriends and to use social media, and for lastly they will say they can use it for some educational purposes. So we can monitor youngsters in between them creating gatherings like clubs and stuff, and we can use like two individuals to monitor each other, like how much of time they are spending for the mobile phone usage, and then we can group that as per day, per week, how many hours they are wasting. So then they can like forming another group and discuss among themselves among that they need to spend more time with their family, youngsters themselves, so that they can give a solution that we need to be with our families more, and reading, those hobbies should be improved among us more than using mobile.
So the subjects, like English, Hindi,
so the subjects will do the research. Abhi yaar filmendi gaani pehte hai. The mobile phone users or the smokers want to study it or want to change it. ඒගොල්ලෝ ඊට පස්සේ මේ රිසර්චර්ස් ලා මට මේක කරගන්න ඕන, කොහොමද මේක කරන්නේ, අපි මේකයි ඩිසයින් කරේ, ඔයා මේ අපේ ඩිසයින් එක හොඳ කරලා දෙන්න දාට. අපිට එහෙමයි ස්ටඩි එකයි තියෙන්නේ. සුපර්. සහ ඔයගොල්ලන්ගේ කී තිබුණා young people themselves can take control over their mobile phone use. Some people here will know that one of the things that were rather well in this country for tobacco was people discovering that smoking and sex are enemies. Sex tiyenawa nan smoking ne, smoking tiyenawa nan sex ne. Jeevithu. Mata poddak hitenawa mobile phone kathawak denna. Oggolu kiwata me young people to attract each other kiyala. මට නම් ෂුවර් නෑ. ඒකත් අපි පබ්ලික් එකෙන් අහමු. What attraction? මනුස්සයෙක් එක්ක ෆිසිකලි කිට්ටු වෙලා දේවල් කරන්න බැරි අය තමයි ෆෝන් එක බලන්නේ. ෆෝන් එකෙන් තමයි උන් අත ගන්න. උන්ව බඳින්නේපා කියලා. ඌ දිගටම ඉන්නේ ෆෝන් එක එක්ක, ඈ දිගටම ඉන්නේ ෆෝන් එක. Maybe as bad as tobacco, I don't know. Now take 2 minutes in each group and consolidate the ideas that we discussed. and we will finish at 12:30 as planned. My session is over. Again, mage velawa dan iwarai. Matath thiyunani vinadi 20 eka dan pawichchi karanna. Hari. So you can leave at 12:30 as planned or we hope. Then we have a group ekama ganna anith groups wala kiyapu. What did we hear from each of these other groups? And then take the ideas that came from them first. It is, we need to disseminate this culture throughout the medical profession and throughout the public. Right? So we will do something starting tomorrow. The idea ka hamo hoga. It was a anik group selling ahiche ka matak. Abhi hita pe gutarakta. ඒ ගෲප්ස් කියපු එකයි අපි කියපු එකයි ඒකට මමත් දාපු කෑලි ඒ ගෲප්ස් වලින් ගත්ත ඒවයි කරලා මොකක් හරි පුද්ගලික ඇජෙන්ඩා එකක් හදාගන්න. අඩු ගානේ හිතන විදිය හරි වෙනස් කරගෙන යන්න. ඔක් කරන දෙයක් දාගෙන. එහෙනම් පහක් විතර ගන්න. ඕගොල්ලෝ නැගිටින්නෙම නැතුව තාම උනන්දුවෙන් කතා කරනවා දැක්කොත් ඊට වඩා දෙයි වෙලා. හරි. ඒකත් දුර යන්න දින නැහැ එහෙම නැගිට. ඔක්කොම සාකච්ඡා ටික ගන්න දැන් මේක. අනිත් අය කියපු ඒවත් එක්ක.
Excuse me everyone. Please, before you all leave, we would like for you all to kindly fill the evaluation forms and return them back to the coordination group.
Now, after 30 seconds, we will stop. If there are queries about health promotion and how to do that, I am not accessible, so you have to ask during the when api me wede kara dan mokadda ilangata karanna one kiyala. That's the bottom one. The other is for PPIE related matters. There are a whole panel.
Yeah. So you all can contact us through that. So Manur is at top, Manur is over there. I'm at the bottom,
and
last
one, the middle one is our general PPIE email address.
So,
I'll leave that there for a while. So let's conclude this workshop. I want to thank the Sri Lanka Medical Association and all its staff for facilitating and supporting this workshop and organizing it. I'd like to thank everyone from IRD, and I'd like to thank Professor Athula Sumathipala for providing his leadership all the way from UK, although he's not here today, unfortunately. He was supposed to be here. And I'd like to thank Dr. Nihala Besinghe, all my staff, everyone here, and all the participants. Thank you for coming and making this a really nice experience for us as well. So thank you very much. I hope you all learned something. And I'll see you all again next time at one of our other workshops. And I hope you all continue to take this message of PPIE and health promotion forward. Thank you very much.